We'll start with any public announcements from the commission.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
We had the groundbreaking for the pollinator habitat on Hollis Road, the 5th of November. It was fairly well attended. I think there was, I don't know if there was an article in the ledger or not, but we took some pictures and submitted an article. So it's underway. There are a few trees planted, and we're getting ready to move forward.
Great. Any other comments from the commission? Seeing none, any public comments from the public?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Because this is a continuation of some matters in the hearing, will there be opportunities for the public to comment during the proceedings?
Yes.
Thanks.
All right.
Wait, was one more. Mr. Boucher, you here?
Yeah.
Okay. Mr. Boucher here wanted to present something to the commission really quick under public comment.
Okay. I'll get you just to sit at the end of the table here and speak into the microphone. Just give us your name and address.
Yeah, my name's Ed Boucher. I'm from Wilson, Mass. Representing Matt Olson, Ashman LLC.
Pass these
house. Yeah, pass those around, please.
Jack?
What we have here is we need to tie in the sewer for this lot, okay? And it was designed to go connect right into the sewer line, right, you know, straight in to the road. But the highway superintendent doesn't want him to cut into the road right now because it's too late in the season. And there's already an existing stub off the road just south of the lot. Just opposite lot 6, which they want to go down and tie into that, okay? So in other words, it's a forced main, so it doesn't have to have any gravity or anything, so it just wants to feed into that lot, okay? But in order to do that, they need to, they're obviously passing, you know, closer to the wetlands.
So the stub runs along the western property line?
Yeah,
is that where you're talking?
Yes, you go down on the bottom, it says existing 2-inch sewer.
It's right at the entrance to the school.
Okay, I see it way down there, yeah.
Yeah, they want to connect that and run the 2-inch sewer all the way up and then turn it left into that, okay? So
if I can just interject here, I went out with Mr. Olson this morning and looked over the terrain, and I suggested that he have Mr. Boucher come up for direction from the commission under public comments just very quickly to see if you guys wanted to pursue an amendment or if you wanted to pursue a field change. Now, I'm looking at this, and all the work is taking place on the edge of the sidewalk. It's a short trench, quick job, open, close, that's it. It's not affecting the wetland.
They've already run the line through the lot.
There's a line.
No, I don't think the line
can go through the lot yet. It has to go down and then around and then up. His only other alternative was to actually go at an angle and cross the wetland. This case is forcing him to put in an E1 pump system.
Yeah, but the one across the lot's already been approved, okay?
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, on a previous site plan.
Draw on there where you're looking to put the new one.
It's running, it is running on here.
It is running on here. It's this line right here.
See it running all the way down?
Okay, so that's the one he's looking to do, okay.
Yeah, I'm sorry if I wasn't.
It's within the right-of-way, the road.
Yes, it is.
Right?
It's in the back of the sidewalk.
Yes, it is.
How deep down does it have to go? How deep down?
It's going to have to be a minimum of 4 feet, okay?
So it doesn't freeze.
That's all you need.
Force main, so they don't have to put it.
There's no gravity.
Yeah.
There's no gravity, so it's just a minimum of 4 feet.
Because he's running, because going this way, he's going to have to run it uphill. So he's going to have to do a force.
But he's still within 10 feet of the.
Yeah, unfortunately, this project's going to require a variance. So I don't see how he can't file an amendment.
Yeah. See, about 15 feet.
Yeah. But, I mean, yeah, we definitely have to file for an amendment where it's within the 30-foot no disturbance zone.
So you're going to have to grant him a waiver from the 30-foot zone?
Yeah. Well, that's what he'll be asking for.
Okay. Yeah, from a legal standpoint, that would make sense.
Yeah. Okay.
Because area right here, the wetland's actually uphill.
Yep.
You know, it's this area here that we would be concerned about. That's
but he's still going to have all the construction,
exactly.
You know, 15 feet from the edge of wet, so. Yeah, so we'll have to file an amendment for
it. So I got to give this guy kudos. He came right to the office. Mm-hmm. He's been straightforward with everything he's done. So
Okay.
So we need to file an amendment.
Yep.
Yeah.
file for an amendment.
See, in town, we have a 30-foot no-touch zone.
Yeah.
And you're going to be technically within that zone.
Yeah, I understand that, yeah.
So in order for that, for them to allow this, they would have to reopen the hearing, grant you a waiver from the 30-foot no-touch zone, and then just reissue that order for that lot.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So how do we do that? Just...
You can have Mr. Olson come in contact with me, and I'll go over the procedure with him, because I've got a checklist for it.
Okay.
Okay?
Yep.
Thank you, Mr. Boucher.
All right. Thank you very much.
Have a good day. All right. Any other public comment from the public? All right. Seeing none, we'll open our first hearing pursuant to Mass General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Town of Lunenburg Wetland Protection and Municipal Bylaws. A public hearing for a request for determination of applicability by Claire Schmidt for work at 398 Sunset Lane will be held. Work entails installing a ranch fence and adjusting dock within the lake and the buffer zone thereof.
All right. Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Luck.
I am in a butter, so I will recuse myself from this.
Okay. And Phyllis, you're going to present for the applicant. All right. If you can have a seat and speak into the mic and just give your name and address.
Phyllis Luck, 50 Sunset Lane.
Okay. And do we have a file on this, Matt? All right. I know some of us got a chance to go out there. I don't think Ken was. If you just give a quick description of what we were doing.
Okay. Claire, at that end of the peninsula, people own land on both sides of the road. And Claire had a fence on the side that's opposite her property that had fallen down. And she had some people replace that fence. Since it was already, you know, the fence had been there, she just had it replaced. It didn't occur to her that she would need to get permission to just replace it. And do you want to talk about the dock as well?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. There's a dock in the water that's cement pilings.
They're like
it's
cement slabs. They're slabs piled up, like maybe 3 foot by 8 foot.
They're stacked up on top of each other?
Just
yes.
Like that, stacked up on top. Yeah.
And they're starting to sort of move over a little bit, I think just because of the wall, you know, force of water over time. And she wants to have someone come in and just straighten those out. She's asked us for permission to access the property through our driveway, which it's out of the water now, so she can go down through our driveway and go around, you know, and just be on the sand because of the way the water's down. And there won't be any disturbance. They're not going to be touching the ground at all. They're just straightening out those cement slabs so they don't fall over.
Yeah, so basically the rail fence was there, it's just replaced, and is actually an existing 319 Grant rain garden right there at the low spot, which is working very well to help protect the runoff from that section from getting into the lake.
For the fence, did they dig new posts for that?
It looked like the fence was completely new, but you had said
yeah.
They had just hand dug the posts
yes,
to put them in. So
it,
this is more of a forgiveness, they've already put it in.
Yep.
So.
And it was to replace the existing.
To replace the existing, yeah. I mean, it was exactly the same structure.
Yeah.
You know, the pictures with that beautiful sunset. Yeah, that was the one that was all fallen in.
Okay.
And then the dock is basically just, like you said, concrete slabs piled maybe 8 high. And with the water down, I think they were going to have Proctor's
yes,
excavating
okay.
go in, run along the water line, which, and stand
right
back
now.
Up. Yeah. Yeah, the only suggestion I had was to put in the request that this is a one-time adjustment to the dock.
Mm-hmm.
So if they do it again, they would have to come back. So it's
okay.
not a blanket whenever they need to go out and push them back up and whatever they need to do to it. So that would be my only suggestion. Other than that, I had no problems with it. So, and I know Jack was out there,
and
Todd was
then,
out there.
And then whatsoever, in fact, I was glad to see you putting the fence back up there. Mm. You could see how if somebody was driving along and it was a bad night.
Yeah.
You'd have something to bounce the beams against. You'd think you were... So I thought that was a great thing. And, pilings do need to get straightened out,
mm-hmm.
so I'm all for it.
Yeah.
I'll put the one-time provision in the findings of fact when we issue the permit.
Okay, yep, during the drawdown time, because there's, you know, the water's 10 feet out from there when the drawdown's complete, so. All right, no, I see no problem with that. I'll accept a motion for a negative determination with the added caveat of a one-time adjustment.
So moved.
Motion, we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you. All right, someone want to grab, grab Carl? I guess you're the closest to the door.
Someone said you could stay there.
Oh, we were in the...
In the booth, troll booth.
All right, moving on to our next hearing pursuant to Mass General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Town of Lunenburg Wetlands Protection and Municipal Bylaws. A public hearing for a request for determination of applicability by Gerald Melanson for work at 51 Spring Street will be held. Work entails the removal of an old retaining wall and stairs to be replaced by a new wall and stairs within the buffer zone. Mr. Melanson?
Yes.
If you want to come and have a seat. And just give us a description of what you're looking to do.
Currently, there's a older railroad type retaining wall for the parking area in front of the home, and that wall has been knocked down. Not sure when that happened. I just recently moved there. Mm-hmm. Perhaps a snowplow operator or something. And portion of that wall is resting on the home. Some of those railroad ties are rotted out. So we're just looking to replace that retaining wall with a stone block wall.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and I think four of us were on the sidewalk.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I was pleased to see that actually the wall's going further back.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we're going to...
Further away from the lake, so that was a positive step. Yep. It's replacing a wall that was actually damaging the house. Nice, so no problem with it.
Yep. Yeah, and it's on the far side of the house from the lake, so
correct.
There really isn't going to be any disturbance. It'll definitely get those oil-soaked ties out of there. So,
right.
Yeah, that's not a problem. The only thing was perhaps a little erosion protection from the edge of the house, because of course everything they're doing behind the house,
mm-hmm.
the house will stop the erosion if we get a big storm and you start to get runoff and
yep.
water running down through there. But if you can, now there was a chain link fence.
Yes.
So maybe in front of the chain link fence. The chain link fence, I assume, staying?
Yes.
Yeah, and then that will support the hay bales or the wattles, whichever you get, just
okay.
to help keep anything from flowing down into the lake. So.
No problem.
No, other than that, and when were you looking to do it, and what's your time frame?
As soon as you tell me I have permission to do it,
okay.
the excavator will be there to remove the old retaining wall.
Okay, so we'll get this tied up during over the winter?
Yes, yes. Within the next 2 weeks, if possible, before
okay.
the snow flies.
All right. Any other questions from the commission? Any questions from the public on 51 Spring Street? Seeing none.
Just a note.
Yes.
Legally, under the determination provisions of the Wetland Protection Act, if he is given a negative, he can perform work prior to the appeal period expiring at
mm-hmm.
his own risk.
At his own risk, yep. All right, I'll accept the motion for a negative determination
so
with the addition of the erosion protection.
So
we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All right, you're all set. Moving forward with our next hearing pursuant to Mass General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Town of Lunenburg Wetlands Protection and Municipal Bylaws, a public hearing for notice of intent by Richard Contex for work at 355 Northfield Road will be held. Work entails installation of a septic system, a driveway, and a single-family home within the 200-foot riverfront. Good evening.
Good evening. How are you?
Good.
His, here, I'll get it.
I think it's on. We have a mic if you're going to be.
I'll sit down.
Okay.
Just put this right here.
And that's a wireless pedestal mic, too. You can take it around.
Upside down.
You're upside down? Well, you might be right side up.
Oh, that's pretty good. New technology.
All right.
And I have some smaller versions if you have a hard time seeing that. I'll pass those around now. Thank you.
You mean kind of like a fax machine, new technology?
I know, huh? In color. Here's my green cards.
You know you can do certificate of mail now.
Yeah. It's habit, I guess.
I know. Anybody else?
Is
there anybody that's here for this hearing that would like a copy of this? Add extra, so there you go.
Thanks, Matt.
great. You want to describe to us what we're looking to do?
Proper forms.
Okay.
So my name's Neil Gorman from David E. Ross Associates, representing the property owner, Richard, and Richard Contaxis. He's also the applicant. And this is a familiar project to the commission from 2008. There was an order of conditions issued under the DEP number of 208-0911. And it was for a similar project for single-family home, driveway, and a septic system on this kind of axe head lot here that is 2.1 acres. This lot was cut off in 2008 from the existing house up in the front. Bisecting the property is the stream, an unnamed perennial stream. And the red here is the 100-foot riverfront zone. And then the blue here is the 200-foot riverfront zone. So as you can see, a portion of the construction of the driveway, the house, and the grading for the sewage disposal system is within the 200-foot riverfront zone. The property is fairly flat to about where our siltation barrier is, and then it drops off about 20 feet in elevation to the stream. So all the proposed disturbance is on the, obviously, the uphill and the flatter side of that property. The original design had a single-family home in the general location of where we have the single-family home posed here in red, but they also had a detached garage further to the north. Mr. Contaxis, the new owner, wanted to have an attached garage and asked us to put this information on the plan with the new house layout. So the unique thing about this project is the leach field was built back in 2008 when they built the upgrade for the existing house, because they piggybacked each other and there was a grading easement for each system abutting each other. So the leach field is already in place and graded. We are just proposing now to build the house and add the septic tank to connect to the existing leaching facility. Being that we are in the riverfront zone, we are the proposed disturbance is under the 10% of the riverfront area on the property. So we're in generally the same area that we were before previously approved. The nearest point of disturbance to the bank is 143 feet at this point right here. There will be some grading around the driveway area to enter the garage. And in that case, we have a boulder wall proposed between the grading and the stream to keep the grading to a minimum. And that will kind of act as a natural permanent marker for future reference as to how far to disturb. We also have some plantings proposed along our area limit of disturbance, which again was similar to the previous approval in 08.
The plantings show in green, is that what the plantings
are? Yes, the plantings are the green. Okay. So, again, trying to make it as natural as possible to help the property owner in the future know where his limitations are.
What's the spacing on the trees and the variety?
They're about 20 to 25 feet apart.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Mm-hmm.
Just wanted to reiterate my report. There were three things that I recommended. One was the discs.
Well, let him finish the... It wasn't marked on here. Let him finish the presentation first.
Okay. That's nearly about it. So,
okay. One question I had. What is the limit, the threshold for disturbance?
The maximum is 10%.
Yep. And 10% of what's your riverfront?
We have 72,770 square feet of riverfront area within the property.
Okay, and your disturbance is?
7,265 square feet.
7,265.
Just under the 10%.
Okay, so we've got an additional, if my math holds, 12 square feet beneath the threshold?
Pretty close, yeah.
Okay. Can we extend that boulder wall where we're so close to the threshold, or try to put a few more boulders? I fear a tree every 25 feet may not suffice as a block to inhibit further development.
Can carry around the corner or through the corner?
Yeah, bring it down. At least in the area of the septic system.
Over this way?
Yep. I mean, we already got it halfway there, might as well just.
Yeah, again, that was just because of the amount of more fill in that area. This is going to be a walkout basement on this side.
Again, just to inhibit further development and growth.
If the commission would like to see that, then, you know.
And you carry it up the driveway as well, partly, basically up to the 200-foot.
So you want the trees and the boulder wall all?
Yep.
Up to 200 feet, yeah.
Wow, okay.
Yep, marking the limit of work. And that will hopefully inhibit further encroachment. As always happens.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
Was your thought on that, like a boulder wall or a boulder every 3 or 4 feet?
Honestly, myself, I'd like to see them just continue the boulders running right along. I mean, they've got grading the whole way, all the way along the limit of work anyway, so.
Okay.
Boulder wall could basically demarcate the limit of work as well.
Correct.
Yeah, for sure.
But that also demarcates a limit of encroachment where they're 12 square feet from the max anyways. That just kind of prohibits the pool from popping out here and the shed from popping out here.
One of the things I noted in my report was the fact that they basically have hit the limit of riverfront alteration, that we could either do some type of a deed restriction in the order similar to what we did on reservoir, or we could do something that's written in the order that survives the certificate of compliance.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea, put in a conservation restriction.
And if the commission is open to it, we have those metal discs.
Yeah.
To do, we can do them along, if they could put them up along the plantings.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you probably want to survey locate the hay bales and silt fence.
Certainly.
Erosion protection.
Yep.
Because it's such, I mean, you 12 square feet.
Yeah. Survey stakeout, you mean?
Survey stakeout.
Stakeout the bounds. Yeah, understood. Sure. Absolutely. I agree with that.
We just had a recent enforcement action where that didn't happen.
Right. No, I agree that with the tight limitations, staking a site out, and we'll be staking out the house, and we can certainly stake out the citation barrier.
Yep.
And would we go with a deed restriction?
Yeah, the conservation restriction.
Conservation restriction.
Yep. And I believe that's perpetual from owner to owner.
Okay.
For perpetual restriction,
yep.
Basically just cannibalizing.
Right. Yeah, just again, where they're so close.
And all it really does is acknowledge
and it's
that
only downhill from there into the,
right,
the brook.
Right. And he knows that, right. And any future buyers will know that.
Well, yeah, it would stick out like a sore thumb.
Right. If they do a title search, it'll jump up.
Well, it's also something, an issue we've run into with DEP, and one of the things we're doing is we're giving them those deed restrictions because then they flag it in their files, too.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I know you said you wanted them to extend the wall along the entire line. Mm-hmm. I'd be open if they spaced the boulders every, you know, 6 feet or so on center. I mean, that's not an insignificant cost there to put those boulders along there, and I think
I would agree with that. I mean, you don't want them to have it look like a fortress, a walled fortress
if
around their house.
You define the size of a boulder?
I'm open to suggestions.
Every 6 feet.
Again, this boulder wall that we have proposed here is more of a retaining wall in the sense that it's holding back fill. So I believe there is a detail on page 1, which I didn't include it on your, but it does specify the size of the boulders.
Mm-hmm.
But all along, this grading is already in place from the prior construction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And again, this is just minor grading. It's not to be retained. It's just grading to make sure that we have a walkout basement in the back of the foundation.
Yeah.
So I think the homeowner would prefer to be spacing out those boulders rather than continuing a wall all along the back.
It doesn't show the size on the plan of the boulders in the wall. But I would think something on the order of 2 to 4 feet in diameter, every 6 feet or so, seems reasonable.
Yeah, on the plan, it has a half yard minimum size. Half yard.
Where?
Hold a retaining wall, half yard size.
Oh, that must be a second. That must be a second page.
Yeah, here it is. So 3 by 3 by 3 would be 27. 2 by 2.
Yeah.
So there's 4 by 8.
I think I agree with Todd. I think that to ask him to bring that wall entire. Around the limit of work.
We'll leave it up to the applicant, but a minimum of a boulder spacing every 6 feet.
Yeah.
They're roughly the same size boulders if you had.
Okay.
Or if they want to just continue a small wall, something that will permanently demarcate.
Fair enough.
Could we say a boulder 2 feet plus or minus 6 inches?
Well, they have it in the, it has to be, they have the spec, they have a half-yard boulder.
Yeah, it's right here.
It's a half-yard boulder.
Oh, okay.
For the retaining.
So that's a good-sized boulder.
Yep.
It's 1,000 pounds, and they're not moving that with a John Deere lawnmower.
Yep.
So, all right, so we have the conservation restriction, survey locate the hay bales and silt fence, and a wall and trees along the edge of work as shown on the plan.
Up to 200 feet.
What's that?
Up to 200 feet from the, surrounding the property.
Well, basically, yeah, from blue line to blue line.
Okay.
Were there any other?
The deed restriction also.
Yep, the conservation restriction, yep. Okay, so those 4 points. We cover everything you had on your recommendations?
Mm-hmm.
All right, any comments from the public on 355 Northfield Road? Yes?
I'm Jay Schwartz, I'm the abutter.
Mm-hmm. If I can just get you to come up, Mr. Schwartz.
What's that?
I just need you to come up and talk into a mic. Yeah, he can just slide the, that's a wireless one, he can talk right.
I am Jay Schwartz, I'm the abutter.
Could I have your address?
379 Northfield Road.
Thank you.
This one here where it says Schwartz?
I'm concerned about the runoff from the, from this section here into my property, this little low area here. Is there going to be any grading to kind of bring that back?
Would you like me to?
Yeah, no, you can.
Oh, based on topography here, this, where it says Lot 2, this is quite flat right here between the proposed construction and the Schwartz property. And our nearest disturbance is some 20 feet before that slope gets steep, so I think if this is being maintained as natural vegetation, that I don't think there'll be any concern of any, you know, runoff in that direction. That isn't naturally going there already.
Yeah, the edge of their work is basically the dotted line, which is 60 feet from the property line?
Yep. Yep, 50 feet.
So no disturbance in this area here?
Nothing at all, nope.
Everything is on that side of that dash line.
Yep.
And here's the steep slope here. We're a good 10 feet on the uphill side of that steeper slope. So everything here won't be touched.
And it looks.
We've also asked for, and they've agreed to, a deed restriction on anything outside the proposed development line to remain in its natural state.
Okay.
So the development envelope you see out here would be the limit on that property in perpetuity.
Okay.
Yeah, and it looks like the center line of the house and the septic system is the peak, so anything, looking at the plan, anything on the right side is going to be flowing towards the Ruth house.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so. And then the way you've got it graded, it looks like most of the rest of the house is going to continue on. I don't see the north arrow, but.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, so it's going to be heading south, so you really haven't added anything going to the north at all with the way you've got it graded.
And this is a fairly flat driveway here.
Yep. So.
So very minor grade changes, to be quite honest. That boulder wall's only a few feet tall, a couple feet tall.
Mr. Chairman, one of the things I recall from our site walk.
How far off grade will this be? Elevation? The boulder wall? 95, approximately 3 feet in this location here, 3 or 4 feet. Over in this corner, we're at about 2 to 3 feet boulder height.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, one of the things I recall from our site walk is there are a number of debris piles and brush piles on the site that are existing now. Do they all fall within the existing limits of work as shown on this plan?
I would believe so. I know when this was originally built, they kind of accessed through here, so I believe that's where the debris piles are now. But I haven't located them since then. I know they're fairly close to the two leach fields that were built.
Good size pile, a lot of old cut up wood right by the wall.
I'm not sure if Danny remembers what's out there or not, but. Not sure.
I would think, I don't know how the other commissioners feel, but if those piles are slightly outside this proposed limit of work, I would think it would be prudent to remove those brush piles.
Fair enough.
Just, you know.
Yep. Fair enough.
Being good neighbors.
Oh, absolutely.
All right. Yeah, because you've got a beautiful view going out in the backyard, so I'm sure you want to keep it as clean and natural as possible.
I'm sure he wants to clean it up.
Yep. All right. Mr. Schwartz, did he answer your questions?
That's fine.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, that brings up a really interesting question. We know that outside, thank you. That brings up a really good question. Outside of the area, work of error, this is somewhat of still a field. Are we going to be allowing him to trim it, clean it, mow it? Keep the trees down?
Well, I think most of that belongs to the neighbor.
Oh, in the back section here?
No, the field was to the was on the other side of
the to that's the back the, here?
I no, was, that was the edge of the woods.
Yeah, there's low tree growth, and there was a smaller area that we were able to walk through without having to work real hard.
Yeah, but I...
Mr. Chairman?
I think that...
There is an existing tree line.
The tree line goes right through the
right
front
through
of
the
house.
Out to here, so the,
oh, okay.
There isn't any field the here. Then. There is an old field stone wall, but...
Yep, we found the field stone wall.
Okay.
But yeah, no, I think, Jack, most of the construction is going to be where you're talking, where that low debris was and that little bit of landing, and then the whole rest of the front is the neighbors. So.
Yep.
So if they wanted to let it grow up so they didn't have to see their neighbors,
I don't think
we'd have a, and it's outside our jurisdiction at that point anyways.
Right.
All right. Any other questions or comments from the public? All right. Seeing none, we have the proposal as submitted with the inclusion of a conservation restriction. You got this all?
Yeah, it's already all down.
All right. Conservation restriction, survey locate, hay bales and silt fencing, erosion protection. Boulders and trees along the limit of work inside the 200-foot riparian zone, and if you so choose, removing the debris outside of the limit of work. Did I miss anything?
The boulders, traffic in 200 provides a deed restriction. Every 6 feet, we would define that.
Yep, now 6 feet or a solid wall.
6 to 8 feet out.
In the same spec as the plan, the half yard boulders.
Yep.
All right, I'll accept a motion to approve based on that.
So moved.
A motion, do we have a second?
Second.
Motion and second. Any other discussion? All right, all those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 Aye. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a great night.
You too.
Busy one.
All right, moving forward, call our next hearing to order. Pursuant to Mass General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40 as amended in the Town of Lunenburg Wetlands Protection and Municipal Bylaws, a public hearing on a notice of intent by Ron and Deborah Seeley for work at 899 Flat Hill Road will be held. Work entails installation of a septic system to replace a failed system within the 100-foot buffer zone. Good evening, Jack.
How are you?
Great, how are you?
Not too bad. Just give me a quick second here to set things up.
Everything for us to sign?
Well, I have a bunch of stuff to sign.
Oh, why don't we slide a couple of them around while Jack's getting his easel set up?
Determinations for Tana Cole and Alan Cassimi. It's the green stripe is the signature page.
You're finding a fact is attached to this, Matt?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Very back page. Very back page.
There you go.
There you go.
And the only other thing I think that we had talked about was the riprap going down the driveway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can have that.
Okay. just pencil that in there, Carl, just a riprap. All right, I'll slide those around. What have we got today, Jack?
I have a septic system upgrade at 899 Flat Hill Road for Ron and Deb Seeley.
Updated plans.
Who are in the audience with
new ones?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The pink is the property line. Blue is Lake Shirley. We have a tree line running up the fence line over here. This is a two-bedroom house. The light yellow here represents a metal septic tank, and then some sort of a leach field is either on the property line, just inside it, just outside it. Nobody knows. There's no records of it. What we're proposing is a septic tank, a microfest pretreatment unit, and a concrete galley chamber system for the new leach field. There is a existing retaining wall right along the edge of this house here. That's going to be replaced by a block wall. As noted here, it's going to run out just to the edge of the microfast tank and then angle towards the middle of the backyard. That's going to help hold the fill and grading back that's required for the new septic system. That will have a poly barrier wrapped on the inside of that wall and pretty much wrapped three quarters of the way around it. We have Lake Shirley to contend with. We have an existing shallow well on site. We have another existing shallow well on the next property, the Minol property, which is the trailer right at the bridge. And there's also a drilled well on the Codzis property, which is to the south. Very tight quarters, trying to pack everything in. And you can see I've labeled the 25-foot no touch. I apologize for not putting in the 30-foot, but we are still outside of it or just on the edge of it. We do have the 50-foot, which we are just outside of it with the septic system. So Title V, we meet regulations. We are going to be in front of the Board of Health on Monday for variance hearing for several variances that we'd be looking for to replace the system. Basically, that's it in a nutshell.
All right. One of the concerns we did have was some of the works inside the 100-year floodplain?
Correct. It's about 110 square feet, mm-hmm. which breaks down to about 22 cubic feet that's going to be displaced. Which it should be shown on the plans that you have with the shaded area.
I see, unfortunately, I don't really see much of the existing grading on here.
It's very, very light.
Yeah.
I apologize for that. It's just the way our mm-hmm. printer works. Were you on site last weekend?
Yep.
Okay.
So if you have 110 square feet, you're going to try to regrade downslope a little bit to gather that back? I mean, it looks like you have a little bit of a slope coming up.
In which area, Rich?
Just south of the shed.
In this area here?
Yep.
Well, now you're down in elevation 300 down
mm-hmm.
in here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but when we're walking out there, if you kind of dragged some of that at the 301 back up, just try to gain that back a bit.
The only area that we could do that would be over in here. I mean, it's fairly flat, but
yeah.
I mean, we'd have to do that over in this area here.
Mm-hmm.
Outside that 30-foot no touch.
Yeah. All right. I suppose myself up. What'd you say it was 12 cubic feet?
22.
Anybody else have any questions or concerns?
Mr. Chairman, just trying to understand the retaining wall. Mm-hmm. It says it's at 307 is the top, but does the end of it slope down or something? Or because it goes above the grade?
309 is the top that comes from the house out, mm-hmm. and then once you get to a certain point, it will start to drop off. Okay. It'll be angled down. It'll be pitched down.
Will it match the grade, or will it be slightly above the grade?
It'll be slightly above the grade, but it'll match that slope okay. coming down.
I notice that it just sneaks into the 50-foot. Is there any way to modify the grade just to keep it out of the 50-foot? It's just barely in it.
What, the wall? I mean, you've got all that other grading that's well within the 50-foot.
Yeah, it's not the grading, it's the structure. We have a no structure zone up to 50 feet.
It's going to be, you're going to end up creating a pocket underneath that deck that's going to hold water. So one of the reasons why we did that is just to keep water flowing from here all the way around. We didn't want to create a dam situation underneath that deck.
I'm sure you're right. It's just hard for me to see the impact on the deck back here of
it's hard cutting that back a little bit. The existing grades that are there.
We have this is a 305 in here, so you have a 304, 303. So right now we have a 303 tying in here. If we were to bring a 304 and a 305, now we're creating a low spot underneath that deck that's there. You're going to end up creating a pond if any of that runoff gets down in there. So basically, you're keeping everything from the deck by the well, keeping that flowing just as it is for any runoff that comes through there. If you were to shorten that wall up, you'd have to bring those contours around and tie them in. And then now you're
just rotating the wall. Then you maintain the grade in front of the wall, and then you keep the structure.
Yeah, I suppose we could do that. We'd have a little bit more grading.
Have it not be straight.
Yeah.
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 Back.
And then just wrap those yep. grade lines right into it.
Yep.
Because of the offset for all the wells.
Yeah. Daniel's blocks are 4 feet. Those
six.
6 feet long, so you're looking at just twisting one block at the
yeah.
end.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it can be done.
Thing to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that would be a good solution, and it keeps us out of that, you know, regulation issue of the 50-foot no structure. So it would make things a lot easier.
Yep, I agree.
That's the engineer.
Yeah, I guess the question is this leach field here? Why do we have to have a rig? You couldn't turn a little bit like that?
You have a well here, and you have a well here. Mm-hmm. So what I tried to do is split the difference as equal as I could.
Yeah, but there. You're both within 50 feet on both sides.
Exactly.
Yeah. I mean, if you turned it slightly, then you'd be outside of our 50 foot.
Well, we could always just turn this block down this way too.
Okay.
Now the only
they could throw some drainage in here to move that down, right? They wouldn't necessarily have to have a puddle underneath the deck.
Well, if you bring that grading around though, you're going to create a berm. Is what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Because the grade over here
is lower than what you're proposing over here, so you're holding it back. Now, the other thing I wanted to bring to the commission's attention is there's an additional block wall that's over in this corner right here to hold the fill back from going into the neighbor's fence. And some of this wall
is also,
it's just on the inside of that 50-foot, but it's right, it's basically going to be right against that fence that's there now.
Is there an existing wall there?
No. There's a wall that runs here, and then it kind of meanders out this way, but I think it's just below that fence. It's kind of buried in the shrubs, right?
It was hard to see where I'm...
Yeah, but it's not really, a straight up and down wall, because there is a slope in there, so...
And you said you have not been to the Board of Health yet?
Monday.
Monday. What variances are you asking for?
They're right up in the upper left here, Rich. 100 feet from a water course, 20 feet from a foundation, well location to a septic, well to a septic should be 100 feet, we're less than that. Well to a septic tank. We have setbacks from, again, Title V variance from a well. Property line to a septic tank, property line to the pretreatment tank, property line to the septic system itself, reduction of the system to the cellar wall, reduction of the septic tank to a cellar wall, and septic system to a private well.
Makes our job look easy.
But it's a tough spot.
Very tough spot with all the wells that we have there.
For the wall in that corner near the neighbor's property, mm-hmm. Did you approach the neighbor and see if they'd be open to like a grading easement or something like that to avoid the wall?
It's kind of funny because there's a double fence there. Mm-hmm. Our clients have a fence, and then about 3 feet beyond that, mm-hmm. they have a fence. So basically I put the wall on the inside of our property so that fence would stay and not encroach on their fence at all. And no, we have not. We wanted to try to keep our fence intact down where it came down, where this part of the fence is going to have to come out, but the rest of this fence we wanted to keep intact.
And it looks like the top of that wall, so it's only going to be about a 3 foot tall wall. Or so.
If that, it's probably just going to be one course high.
Okay.
There's not that much of fill there to hold back. Those blocks are 6 feet long, 2 feet wide, 2 feet tall, so. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, there's a clear need for the wall there.
Agreed.
Yeah. From a health standpoint to get the septic system to fit, as opposed to just something that looks pretty from
it's
the water.
It's not for aesthetic purposes.
Right.
I don't have a problem, Mr. Chairman, with the way that the plan is drawn and the project is proposed.
And Mr. Chairman, I could second that. It's essentially, this is a tough place no matter what. Yep. And sometimes you have to take a little bit of a step back and just say, given the circumstances and implications, I have no real problem.
Okay. And I did get a chance to draw out that 302 line, and it does look like you can, when you're grading, just grade back a little bit more on the 302 line to gain back that.
Did you get a 302?
Right here, the 302.
Yeah.
I think it follows this way.
Yeah.
And then 303 you've tied into here. Mm-hmm. So if you just take this 302
and just want to
push it back up there a little bit, that'll gain back.
We should only get a variance for that.
Okay. With some minor grading that's in there. So. All right. At this point, other than the regrading to make up for the filling of the 100-year floodplain, I don't don't think we came up with any other ideas or changes at this point.
I thought we were going to keep...
Other than rotating
the last block, yep.
The last block.
Yep.
Yep.
We're going to twist that?
Yep.
Okay.
Got to keep that at the 50-foot. That's an easy fix.
Yep.
But the other one, there's not much you can do with that. So with those two changes, my only question is, before we move any further, what is your feeling going before the Board of Health? Do you want to continue this in case they make you change something? Because once we close, if they make you change it, you kind of have to resubmit it, or at least an amendment.
DEP number already too, Matt, right?
Yes, DEP number.
Yeah, let's continue it.
Okay.
In case there's any changes, be safe, and...
And then it'll just be a really quick open, as long as it's the same plan or minor change, so...
Do we want to see another plan with the updated grading and stuff on it, or...
Probably not a bad idea, while we have the time.
Yep.
Spin that little corner of the wall and...
You'll have the changes.
Yep.
And then this way it'll stay open until there's any other changes, if the Board of Health has some.
Yep, yep. All right, so I guess at this point, with the applicant's permission, I'll accept the motion to continue this until... When's our next meeting? December 1st?
December 7th.
December 7th.
I would make that a motion, Mr. Chairman.
I have a motion. Do we have a... Before we get into that, any questions or comments from the public? All right, seeing none, we have a motion for a continuance, and we have a second. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
So just let us know, and honestly, if nothing's changed and you've submitted the plans, I don't think at this point there were any other questions.
Grade change to rotate that section of wall.
The grade change to make up for the...
Floodplain.
Floodplain filling and the last block of wall.
Yeah.
I think we're supposed to have two in the file.
If nothing else changes, you'll get revised plans.
They should be. Okay, great.
They're on here, I just can't read them.
This is the 302 right here. There's no reason you can't. This is Phil.
He says chef.
Bring the 302 over here.
So he can do the compensatory and rotate the block at the same time doing that?
Yep.
Exactly. All right, moving forward.
Considering the tight spot.
There is no alternatives there. Call our next hearing to order pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 131, Section 40 is amended in the Town of Lunenburg Wetland Protection and Municipal Bylaws. A public hearing on a notice of intent by Kenneth Mattson for work at 120 West Street will be held. Work entails installation of a septic system, a driveway, and a single-family home within the 100-foot buffer zone. And did you want to keep sliding these around?
Good evening. For the record, Keith Murray from David Ross.
If we can just hold one second until Matt gets back, because he's taking our minutes.
Yep.
See the number. I was going to ask him how he came up with the number sequence.
This is it, right?
Okay.
120.
120 West Street. Yep.
West Street.
Yep. All right. As soon as you're ready to type, we'll come.
Sorry.
All right.
You want to pass these out there?
Yes. Sure. As I said a moment ago, for the record, Keith Murray from David Ross, representing Mattson Homes.
Jack. Are there any of others here that want to take a look at?
Okay.
Good evening, Bob.
Good evening.
From meeting to meeting to meeting, huh?
Yep.
All right, I think we're prepared, sir.
All right. The property is 120 West Street, and it's a 2.6-acre parcel. And the proposal, essentially, and I'll try to be brief as possible, but answer your questions, obviously. The proposal is construction of a three-bedroom, single-family home, and the construction for the dwelling and a portion of the driveway will be within 100-foot buffer zone, as shown here, 100-foot buffer zone to the wetland. The wetlands were flagged by Steve Sears from our office as well. And the 50-foot no-build zone, no structures within that 50-foot no-build zone, and no work is proposed within 30-foot.
Just make sure you're talking into the mic, or just,
I'm sorry,
it's wireless, so you can move it right to the corner, as you're, the one on the pedestal, there you go, and the people at home can hear.
Okay. So no work is proposed within the 30-foot no disturbance zone. The closest area of work is 41 feet, and it's bordered by the thicker black line, which is essentially the straw wattle erosion control barrier line. And the closest portion of the house, I apologize, is 63 feet to the wetland area. At the closest portion. So there will be some grading, and you'll notice on the plan by the back of the driveway, this is a drive under garage to limit the footprint of the house as much as possible. The house is situated in the back portion because it has to have a certain lot width so that house can be meet that criteria, and it's very close. It's literally within a foot to that front setback line. So trying to keep everything close as possible to the roadway and as far away from the wetland as possible. There is a...
And which setback was that?
It's 175 feet.
Yep.
Setback from this corner,
mm-hmm,
to here.
Okay.
So this corner of the house here and this corner of the house,
mm-hmm,
they're very, very close. So this is going to have to be pinned.
Yeah.
It's going to have to be pinned.
Is that a zoning setback?
It is.
Yes,
yes, sir.
Now, when you make
175 feet from the road?
No, it's the width
of the width.
The lot where that house has to be further than 175.
Thank you.
So much distance through the house.
Thank you.
So the house can be no closer to the road than what we've got for those front corners.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's very close. So there is a little deck that's on the back. The main portion of the house is even further away from the wetland itself. That's an elevated deck, so that's essentially...
It'll be on piers or something.
Yeah, and what we tried to do is we tried to grade it out as quickly as possible. In the back portion of the lot, we try to give them at least 10 to 15 feet around the house. It's fairly level, so somebody can put up a ladder when they're going to do some painting or something like that. And we tried to grade it down as quickly as possible. It's a little steeper than what you normally would see. It's about a 2-to-1 slope, And I expect that that will be taken over by natural vegetation in the future. That won't be mowed or any further encroachment down towards the wetland area. We originally proposed a retaining wall, but it became cost prohibitive on this particular lot. So we're trying to grade it out as smoothly as possible.
So on the north side of the driveway, there appears to be a proposed wall. Is that a boulder wall?
Up here?
Correct.
That is correct. It'll be a concrete retaining wall. It's 2 feet high.
Okay. And what's the, is the top of the wall elevation 99?
That's correct.
Is there a reason why you couldn't raise that so everything that falls on the driveway drains away from the wetland?
That's where it naturally goes now.
But there's not naturally asphalt there now.
That's cool. Okay. Yes. Okay.
That's a good observation.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. But
I'm just trying to keep the runoff.
I can't get it to go all the way to the road here because what happens is, it's about 100
mm-hmm.
here, yeah, going to 114 up here,
mm-hmm.
and then it's going down to 83. So mm-hmm. to be able to, and this is, like I said, it's a drive under garage. Garage elevation's at 100. It would be very difficult to be able to get it. If you're thinking of going towards the road, because that's the only place we could go with it.
Well, my only other thought is putting some sort of buffer on the edge of the driveway to capture the runoff. Gravel buffer or something like that.
Sure. A little bit of a rain garden.
A rain garden.
Wrap or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
That could be done.
Something like that, just designated so it captures the runoff from the driveway, or the majority of it.
I guess the back
on the back side of the wall. The only reason I would say that is because we're cutting it so close to have a turnaround area for this driveway. The reason why I put the wall there is I don't want somebody falling off a cliff when they're backing sure. out of their garage. So the area that we would put it would necessarily be on the other side of the retaining wall.
Yeah.
So like a gravel trench, that type of thing.
Yes.
Infiltration trench.
Exactly.
Okay.
Put up around the side.
Mm-hmm.
The reason why I say that, were you on this lot with this?
I was mm-hmm. not.
Oh, you weren't, yeah.
On this particular lot, there's one thing I looked at was one of the reasons why that wall was there. And when I walked that section where it's going,
mm-hmm.
if you look at the pre-existing conditions right now, the way that thing is going to be cut, there's a little runoff that goes to channels that look like they may
exist erosion channels
go right down.
Yes.
Without that wall, you continue that erosion. Rain garden would hold back and slow that down even further, but it would be critical to extend it around that corner to help that because that's where that channeling starts.
Yeah.
So
actually, let's back up for one second. One question I have is, why is the garage access coming in from the west and not driving straight in from the south? Why do you have to turn 90 degrees to get into the garage?
Because the garage extends almost halfway into the house.
Mm-hmm.
To do that, and I've gone through a number of iterations with this plan,
yep.
the garage would be extended.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, if we extend the garage, I don't have enough room for a turnaround.
So if you extend the garage this way, then have the doors coming in this way,
You're seeing them straight in?
Straight in, yeah.
That's one of the things that the client was adamant against. He, mm-hmm. he wanted to have a drive under this way,
mm-hmm.
not a drive under that way.
Because mm-hmm. that would alleviate most all of the problems in the buffer zone if we had the driveway going straight into the garage and didn't make that big asphalt turnaround area.
Well, we're still going to have, even if you were to do that,
mm-hmm.
it would still be a drive. There would be a turnaround. There would have to be a turnaround here.
Yep.
And you're still going to have an area where the dwelling is still going to, now it's going to extend further over here as well. So yep.
but you're moving quite a bit of that asphalt further away from the wetland and on this side of the pitch, not on the back side.
it's...
It was a question of mine, so I just wanted to throw it out there and let the other commissioners...
I think that that is, the house plans that he had, they lend itself very nicely to a small footprint on the house, as opposed to making it larger, because that talks of, that gets the other rooms in the second story and the third story much larger as well.
Mr. Chairman, if I could ask, in relationship, you've still got a sizable impervial area with regard to the house itself. Where are your dry wells and where is that going to flow?
We don't have any dry wells there, sir.
Okay, so you're going to be just running it right off the side, on or off the roof, no gutters or anything like that?
That's correct.
Flat, I mean...
We could, if you wanted to, obviously...
Do something to just capture that.
Sure. We could put in a trench drain here, or infiltration, just like on the backside of this wall.
Right.
Same thing, sure.
Carry it around the full side of the house, that way whatever's coming off the roof is being captured and not running down the hill.
Yep. And the soils here, it's Charlton soil, so infiltration is going to be, I don't want to say minimal, it's, you know, it's a B-type soils, a C-type soil, so that's fine, and that's why we don't propose dry wells, because groundwater is going to be fairly high up in that area, so you're going to be discharging into groundwater, and I'm adverse to that, but I'm not adverse to a trench drain.
That'd be fine. I think if we're going to be using for the driveway, what's the difference between the house and the driveway in terms of permeability, so... Yeah, let's carry it all the way around that wall.
Okay, sure.
Pot stop? I guess I should turn my mic on, huh?
Yeah, no, I think that's a good idea.
Oh, you're so mean.
Don't go there.
Don't go there.
Okay, I'm turning off now.
I know that I was brief in the presentation, so if you do have any questions, and this is, by the way, it's serviced by, I don't know if it was, I think the minutes or the agenda had mentioned that there was a septic system. It's not. It's town sewer. It's town water.
And they've already installed the sewer line? Or the water line?
Not that I
know
of, sir.
Done work on the roadway?
They've started to get through that roadway area. Mm-hmm. That's my understanding. I haven't seen it, to be honest.
So they got the stub in off the street because you can't get into the street after,
right,
at this point moving forward.
They were crunched for time.
Is that what they did? They just put the stub in? Okay.
Yep.
The water and the sewer or just the sewer?
Water and sewer. Water and sewer.
Yep. Yeah.
Chairman, just to get, not let your question go disappear with regard to the side entry on the home. You know, it's in some parts of the country, that's death to the value of a home, is having your garage's front entry. And I agree that aesthetically, and given the turnaround, need for the turnaround, I don't have a problem with that.
Yep. It's a little hard to decipher because there's so many elevation lines. What is the current elevation of the center of the house?
Of the center of the house?
Yeah. Or have you done any calculations how much material has to be removed from the top of this hill to put this house in?
No, I haven't done any earthwork calculations on this at all.
Okay.
I have not. Elevation at the front of the house, the top of the concrete is 108.
No, existing today.
Oh, existing today is it's about 110.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be fairly close to that. It's going to be about 106, 107 going around the house.
Okay. So that'll be the top of the concrete.
Is 108.
Okay.
So you want a foot of reveal,
typically.
And it's a walkout basement in the back, so that's going to, and that's also where we're fighting some grade issues there.
About 6 feet. Big one, man. That was a pretty steep climb.
It looks like you encroach about 9 feet into the within the
50-foot no-build zone. Within that area where you encroach into the 50-foot buffer, do you intend to clear-cut that whole area? Are you going to save some of those trees? I didn't want you guys to have a better feel for that. I'm concerned that
when we're on site, because the limit of your grading is outside of the 50-foot, but your limit of work is inside the 50-foot.
That's correct.
Okay. Can we just demarcate the 50-foot as the limit of work? I mean, you don't have any grading lines going into the 50-foot, so I'm not sure what that...
I don't, but it's so close, and given the slope, mm-hmm. at a 2-to-1 slope, it just offers them no real buffer, mm-hmm. you know, in terms of construction.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it has to be a little give and take.
Well, I understand. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, I can probably do that.
If
there are any trees larger than, say, 12 inches in diameter within that area, I recommend that we save those trees. Any mm-hmm. larger than 12 inches within that area.
Okay.
So
just inside the 50.
Because it is a steep slope.
Inside the 50.
As much as you can.
Because it's a steep slope, those trees will actually help stabilize that mm-hmm. slope and prevent problems in the future. So...
Mr. Chairman, one of the discussions or concerns I had during our meeting is that none of this property was identified, you know, nothing was staked out, nothing was demarcated, and it left us with a pretty wide open, where is this really going to sit, because we couldn't do any legitimate measurements. There's some big, beautiful trees back there. In fact, one of them has a steel post running right through the center of it, growing in around it. And that was one of, I think, my concerns, is that I couldn't get a real decent handle on this. And I know we've had in the past discussions with regard to requesting that the areas be staked out. And I think this is a perfect location to ask that. And I would ask that we continue it and allow them to stake the area out so we can see where they're really talking about. This is quite a hill that they're really talking about taking apart, and we're not sure how far it's going to really set back. We know it's a real sensitive area and very, very steep. It really is. So I'm having a hard time understanding now, especially where we're going to be kicking it so far out, where is this all going to go? You know, and how, you know, because there were some pretty nasty slopes mm-hmm. even associated against the garage area, that existing garage. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, then where the house is proposed, God, you'll need a parachute if you start. You know, so I think that was our guess. And I think, you know, we were having a hard time.
I would support that, because that was very difficult, and it's even difficult here now to relate what I'm looking at here to our visit. So, right. And it should have been staked out, so I would think that it would be appropriate to have it staked out and visit again so we really understand what we're looking at. And we can look at the trees, and we can, you know, yeah. Once we know where it is, then we can see what's important. Mm-hmm.
Do we have anything in writing that asks people to stake it out before our site visit? Because I've been on other sites that
have
been staked out.
No. So. I guess my only concern about dragging it on for that would be, obviously, the house can't move further away. At least at this point, the applicant's not willing to change the design to accommodate some of our concerns. So I don't know if going back out there again, unless you had something that you specifically wanted to see a change. That would be.
I think the trees are concerned,
mm-hmm.
a real concern. There are some very large, stable trees there that are holding the embankment in. I don't mm-hmm. know what's really happening in that. How far does that set in? It was very, you know, we couldn't get down there to get to the end of the vegetation area to do any measurements mm-hmm. to see where it was really sitting. I mean, this is a tough piece of property.
Are you suggesting he can't build a house here?
No, I'm not suggesting that at all.
What are you
suggesting? What I'm suggesting is that the location of that house is sensitive, and for that matter, the vegetation around it and holding that up, Bob, is real sensitive. And,
but if you can't move it forward, what are his options?
I would like to see what it really looks like. And if we don't feel comfortable moving forward, we're going to ask him to modify the design of the house.
Speak for yourself.
Oh, I'm speaking for myself now.
Okay. Yeah. Well, you said we, so.
Oh, excuse me.
All right, well, we have two members that are interested in going back out to revisit the site. Anyone else opposed to that? I know Todd hasn't seen it at all.
I'm open to that. If we don't, my only other comment is where you have the 2-to-1 slope, I have a concern that you're going to have difficulty establishing vegetation. So I would like to see called out on here maybe some temporary erosion control mats until vegetation's established.
Yeah, that's fine. And one of the things, if you consider going forward without continuing, and it's okay, whatever your decision is, it is. I wouldn't be adverse to saying, okay, if there are certain trees out there, we'll make it part of the condition to say that those trees remain.
Mm-hmm. Right. What is your proposed schedule of construction?
He'd like to go as quickly as possible. Okay. I don't have.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. To that end, then, because I had erosion control concerns and a planting schedule some way. If you're going to have a 2-to-1 slope out there in December, how are we going to control that?
Matting or something like that?
I mean, it really has to be a pretty concerted effort on what we're going to do. So if we can get some schematics on and designs on how you're going to do that.
Certainly, sir.
Incorporated in the plan, and I guess I would be the fourth person in favor of having it staked out. If we can stake the corners of the house.
Sure.
With a rough idea of the elevations of what they're going to be at, somehow show them on the stakes.
Sure.
So that gives us an idea of what slope's coming off, where the runoff's going to be going between the wetlands out to the street. And there is a pretty steep embankment that looked kind of gravelly that goes to the neighbor's house.
Yes.
And it looks like from here, most of the water from the driveway, and basically that half of the lot is all going to pitch off that way.
Yes.
Towards the west.
Towards the west, yeah.
Yep.
So that's because it looks like halfway down the driveway is the peak. We're at 101.
About halfway, yeah.
So
yeah.
All of that water is flowing back, flowing off onto the neighbor's. So if we can get the center line of the driveway staked every 40 feet going up, the corners of the house staked, and maybe a couple stakes where this wall for the edge of the driveway is going to be.
Okay, so the corner of the house and what else?
The corners of the house, the
40 feet on, for every 40 feet on the driveway.
Yep, center line of the driveway. The four corners of the house and probably the two extending pieces of the deck. And if we can get a couple on the three western points of the turnaround. So then we can kind of draw our dots.
Did they flag the
the wetland was somewhat
foot and the 50 foot.
You know, if we could flag the 50 foot, would be great.
Yeah, great.
That way we could see the trees that were
exactly
involved.
The wetland was adequately flagged, and the delineation was accurate. One thing I would remind the commission on my report was, and it's along the same lines as what some of you are talking about. The erosion protection here is within the 50 foot. I had asked that the applicant, that you guys may consider asking the applicant to move the bale line up
right.
to match the 50 foot. Because we want that to demarcate the limit of work. So that with the jute matting, I think are actually legitimate concerns for the erosion control. That was my concern, was the erosion control was actually located within the 50 feet. I believe it was 41 feet.
Yeah, I think 41 is what he has on the plan.
But the grading doesn't go into it. So bring that up to match that line.
It does sound like the applicant, though, based on the meeting, would like to do some clearing within the 50-foot zone. So, I mean, I understand that that's his erosion control is serving the purpose of, well, he's not grading.
Yeah, generally, the 50-foot zone was mature trees. There wasn't a lot of brush. It was a mature forest in through there.
There is one thing I would point out in isolated cases, especially with the way the commission seems to be viewing this lot, you do have the power under your bylaw to extend the no-touch zone because you're treating the 50-foot naturally because of the slope more of a no-touch zone than an obstruction zone. Mm-hmm. So the commission may want to actually examine looking at extending that no-touch zone out 20 feet. Because on case-by-case basis, you can extend that zone. Your bylaw gives you the flexibility. They're written out in the regulations, 30 foot and 50. That's the way it was voted in the regulations, but your bylaw allows you the flexibility to move that if you feel the resource needs extra protection.
All right, so you're all set with the marking, the driveway, the corners of the house, the corners of the turnaround, the 50-foot no build zone?
Yep.
All right, and we'll probably walk out there December 3rd.
December 3rd?
Yeah, Saturday, December 3rd.
Also, did you mention the area where the 2-to-1 slope will be graded, maybe either end of that slope on the east side, so we can see?
Well, the corners of the deck were going to be marked, and that looks like the worst of it.
Also, I think right here is...
Oh, over in there?
Yeah.
Okay.
That looks like a pretty good slope as well.
Yep. All right, so the filling on the east side as well?
Just maybe a stake at either end of the proposed grading on the east side.
Outside the buffer zone?
Yes.
So do you want... Outside of the buffer zone, staked as well?
Yep.
Yep.
All right. Any other questions or comments? Any questions or comments from the public? On 120 West Street. Yes, sir. Just your name and address?
Yes.
And actually, if I can ask you to come up to the microphone. Or if you want to give him the handheld mic. Is it on?
Should be.
Check, check.
Is the light on?
The light's on. The numbers are on.
Light's on.
Okay, beautiful. Name and address?
My name is Nicholas Vitelli at 114 West Street. I just wanted to reiterate the concern here for, the topography of this lot. Living right next to it, I know it fairly well. I've been there for 4 years now at 114 West. Quite frankly, to me, it just doesn't seem like a very buildable lot. We can talk all night and go back and forth about moving the driveway location or the garage location, but a house is a house in a very sensitive area there, so I just wanted to express my concern about that. I'd like to, like you guys were talking about, I'd like to see this marked out a little better. Because I just showed up one day with, there was one stake in the ground and an excavator on the other side of it, and I didn't know what was going on, and it's really not marked out well at all. So looking down on that property, there's no way of telling where this house is going to be, in terms of how close it's going to be to the wetland. And that's really all I had to say about that.
Okay. So. Okay. All right, any other questions or comments from the public? All right, with the applicant's permission, we will continue this hearing till December 7th?
Certainly.
Okay.
And December 3rd would be the site walk?
Yes, Saturday morning.
Generally in the morning?
Yep. Yeah, generally between 8 and 10.
8:30 and 10:30.
And actually, if you could be out on site, that would be...
I will be there.
That would be very helpful to the cause. All right.
Do you need a motion?
So I'll accept a motion to continue to December 7th.
So moved.
We have a motion. We have a second.
Second.
Any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
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 All right. We'll see you on
the 3rd. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Moving forward, we'll call to order our first continued hearing pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Town of Lunenburg Wetland Protection and Municipal Bylaws. We will continue a public hearing on a notice of intent for Jameson Van Dyke for the demolition and rebuild of a single-family home at 37 Bird Street.
Just so you know, Mr. Van Dyke had originally bought this in Illinois prior to the implementation of the forms.
Okay.
But he courteously provided us with all the forms anyway. Because I gave him the forms. So they are in his NOI.
All right.
So.
Those two RDAs make it around that we were signing?
Yeah, they're all set. I got plenty of signatures.
Oh, yes, we do.
After we go, we can get that set up.
This was the existing shack there. So that's coming out. This is one in here. 30 foot.
Still nothing. Historical?
Yeah, so the Historical Commission sent a letter to Mike Savinger, the building inspector, stating that they're okay with everything.
Mm-hmm.
So that issue is resolved in regards to that.
Okay. All right, if you want to just give us a quick overview of what you're looking to do again?
Quick overview. Construction of a single-family home with the removal of the existing structure. The existing structure is pretty much unsalvageable. It's an old, worn-down house. It's safer just to call it a day with it. We're going to propose to construct a new single-family home that's within the 100-foot, but outside the 50. Mass majority of the work that's going to be performed on the site will be the general grading around the lot, just to make the house a little bit user-friendly. We are proposing no work within this 30-foot buffer zone. We will be placing hay bale and silt fence erosion control measures around the limit of work. Those measures will be the actual limit of construction and clearing for the site itself. We are requesting from the commission a waiver from the 50-foot buffer. We're proposing to have a small retaining wall constructed near the rear of the house, right through here, just to allow for a walkout basement and make the site a little bit more user-friendly. It's not impacting or trying to impact any kind of movement of anything through the area. It's just there to hold back the grading a little bit more, just to make it more user-friendly for the occupant. Outside of that, there's been no major changes since our previous meeting. If there's any questions, we'd be more than happy to answer them.
What's the setback from the road for the house?
Since it's not set width of road.
Mm-hmm.
It's from the center line of the road, and it's offset, I believe, 60 feet from the center line of the road.
60 feet from the center line, and where would that line fall?
That line would fall right through here. So we're a few feet off of it, but so we're as close as we can possibly get with that.
All right, I see it here, building setback. It's right across there, okay.
There's some stone walls on that property right now. That are kind of holding the hill in place.
From what I've heard from the commission, there were a few small stone walls.
Oh, there were some good ones, yeah.
Yeah.
I just don't know if they're not reflected there. And
no, we did not survey locate them during our initial survey of the site.
I'm assuming the green area is where you're going to be graders.
Correct. And the existing tree line kind of cuts through the center of the house right now, or our proposed house, and kind of continues up through here. There's a little bit of clearing just for getting into the well area, but outside of that, there's not that much clearing that's going to be occurring.
So it looks like the basement floor is going to be basically at the existing grade, so the whole house is going on top of the existing grade?
Yes.
So it looks like we've got 96 coming through here, and the basement's at 96.
And this is the elevation.
How does that become a walkout if the basement floor is at ground level?
Well, the basement floor right now is at 96.9.
Yeah.
Our grade outside that doorway will be around 96.2.
Yep, which so, is looks like that's kind of the existing now.
What's the grade at the front of the house?
The grade of the front of the house would be about 103.5.
So is it actually built up? Is it behind the
so they're building the wall.
So they're building the front up.
They're building the front up.
Which we kind of have to do due to the placement of the septic system and the mm-hmm. offsets that we have to meet for that. So the site, that front portion is actually building up a little bit more than it is right now.
So coming off of Burridge Street, my recollection is it's almost
flat.
Yeah. Flat yeah, now, so you're actually going to build up and you're going to be higher than Burridge Street.
Yep, yep. It'll be about okay. 3 feet higher.
Yeah, the garage, yep. The garage floor is 104, so that's going to be 2.5 feet higher than the road.
Yep.
Another squeaker, huh?
I don't see it immediately, but I bet Todd will. But it seems like you should be able to do something to stay outside of that 50.
I mean, oh, with the wall, yeah.
It's so close, and you're building this up to begin with. Does it have to be built up that high in this area? It's only off by 2 feet, this level, right?
Oh, it's because the garage is higher. So this will be a first floor garage.
Right. Couldn't this be sloped a little steeper back here? You're just looking for two.
They can do the same thing. They can kick it.
Kick it to parallel. Mm-hmm. Yep. I assume the walkout underneath the deck. Is that where the?
The doorway. They're anticipating being pretty close, so if you're like coming down the stairs of the deck, the walkout doorway would be pretty close to that area.
So the walkout towards the stairs end of the deck, or is it right under the deck?
Where's the 50?
Right there.
Why couldn't they just extend the frost wall down, make a frost wall that goes deeper for the garage, use that as your retaining wall, then you don't have to extend the wall down
right
out into the 50.
Right, you mean you said just come through that over and leave this yeah. exposed.
Yeah, it's going to be exposed way. Now because there's no way you're right. going from 100 to 104.
Oh yeah,
so
yeah.
that's already going to be an exposed wall. So they'll just
and this
they
is
can
walk out, so the whole back is exposed. No. So
yeah. regrade it, make more exposed.
Right.
That way we keep the wall out at 50.
Right. Mm-hmm.
The wall's mm-hmm. a wall.
Right. Yeah. So you, I don't know if you could hear that down there. I'm sorry.
So just to make sure we're all on the same page, you guys requested maybe that we pull back that wall just a little bit. Outside the 50-foot buffer.
Either pull it back or eliminate the wall altogether and deepen your garage wall, you know, essentially deepen that wall, so then you eliminate the need for that wall that extends out. Because essentially you're grading to that wall to have more level surface behind the garage. Or
yeah, a little bit of walking.
A little bit.
Yeah, because we have a 5-foot relatively level strip trying to go across or around the side, around the house right. itself, so.
I mean, my thought is if you deepen the wall at the east side of the garage, and then you can take it gradually along the garage and grade it up towards the front, yeah. around the corner, and stay out of 50 altogether. Mm-hmm. Right. That's just...
I knew good suggestion.
Yeah.
yeah. I would prefer to maybe cut the wall in half so that's outside the 50-foot. Have that wall still a little bit there.
I'd be open to that.
That's all we're trying to do.
Just have the grading be adjusted accordingly around it yeah. just to make it yeah. usable.
Yep.
Because I'm kind of hesitant just to get rid of that.
Mm-hmm. Yep, yeah. understood.
So I think if you could revise that before we sign it, speaking for myself, I'd be willing to approve it based on if you'd be willing to make that accommodation.
Make that a condition.
Or we'll make it a condition.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
And do we have a demarcation plan at the 30 foot for how we're going to stop encroachment from that point forward?
We didn't propose any, but using the small little placards, you know, no disturb wetland area, that mm-hmm. seemed reasonable.
request.
Something a little more permanent, yeah.
Boulders?
Yeah, because you are, I mean, you're proposing to be right on the edge there. So you have some sort of permanent demarcation.
Didn't we have
the last plan, like the half-yard boulders every 10 feet?
Six to 8 feet, I believe.
Where would they start them, Rich? At the, right on the corner there?
Right here?
Yeah?
Can I continue it through until you're...
Yeah, basically along the edge of clearing there, yeah.
Yeah.
Where they've, basically where they've made a backyard from what is not there now. Just to prevent encroachment.
Now, the other thing we've used in the past is also just like a mulch buffer.
Yeah.
A permit buffer. I mean, I'd be open to that as well, but I like boulders better.
Myself, where it's right, I mean, they brought it right to the edge, I'd be a little happier with something a little more permanent.
Yeah.
I thought our regulation says something about little placards.
Well, we do have the placards, but myself, I like something a little more permanent because trees can be cut without even thinking about it. All of a sudden, we want a pool in the backyard, the trees go down, and...
There were never any placards there.
Next thing you know, we've got somebody in asking for permission, and the pool's already in the ground.
It's a lot harder to move a one-ton boulder.
Yep. Yes, it is.
Yeah. Unless the kids push it down the hill, but that's right.
Yep, now, so some half-yard boulders every 10 feet or so, run them along there. Removal of the wall outside the 50-foot. And I know you gentlemen had talked about this prior. Was there any other concerns?
Well, I guess you brought up an interesting point. Would we ask for a mulch buffer just to slow down any kind of water moving down that hill? That wouldn't make any effect.
I would think so.
It's too flat.
Yeah.
Great. Okay.
And the areas past that, those old retaining walls are actually staged. It's not a slope, it's staged, so it's interrupted.
Right, it's falling through.
Much of a difference.
Those aren't being affected then?
No.
They were outside of it. Okay, good, good. I like those walls.
To be clear on the demarcation of the 30, it will only be along the areas where they disturb up along the 30.
Yep. And where they fill to the 30.
Right.
Where it gets back natural as we get to the, where the proposed water line is, working out to the well.
Yeah.
I believe it was limit of clearing, was the term used.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, and survey locate the hay bales and silt fence erosion protection prior to construction.
It's been a little while since we've been on the site. Does anyone recall the number of trees in that?
That's a good question. I don't recall
there being a lot of large trees.
There were not a lot of large trees. No.
No. Yeah.
Trees were not an issue.
Yep.
You start going into the 30-foot, they start to become an issue outside.
Right.
They're really
outside the 30 was more vinca and myrtle.
Yeah, it was scrub.
Right. Yeah. Stuff. I think there's one large tree near the house, the existing house, but outside that.
If anything, is one thing I noted in my initial report was that the new proposed structure and the new utilities are actually being located farther away from the wetland than the original structures. Most of the impact on this project is more from the regrading than from the structure itself. Structure actually winds up creating a better scenario wise. So, you know, refining demarcation and, you know, your no-touch zones is more than appropriate.
Mm-hmm. Is anybody living in the house now?
No.
Squirrels, maybe.
So apparently this house here with the pool is not 37 Burridge.
I believe that's the next door neighbor, I believe.
Okay, further down.
If you're near, what's the street, sorry.
You have a few raccoons living in there, but that's
fine. Yeah. Right. And a massive hornet's nest over the back corner.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
We have a big one out in the backyard.
Yeah. Looks pretty good. Last year's hornet's nest.
Is it last year?
All right.
Yeah, I got stung several times during
So any other, any other questions from the commission on 37 Birch? Any questions from the public on 37 Birch?
Yes, Chairman.
I'm going to ask you to come up to the mic.
Yes.
Either that one or the mobile.
Yeah, I'll take the portable one.
Is it on?
Is the light on?
Nobody home. Joe, is that portable mic working?
Try mine, Dave.
Yeah, thanks. Dave Rogers, 82 Highland Street. I'm pleased to hear that the Historical Commission and the building inspector were able to resolve this issue, because it just didn't seem right to me that we had a situation where a known building was going to be torn down, and in order to be in compliance with the rules and regulations, as I read them, you had to go out and list the property and advertise it for sale, and that's disingenuous, because you're going to tear it down. And so the point is that this, to me, was a learning experience, and everyone is a little bit different, and I'm glad that we were able to work it out. But it seems to me that had we used some common sense before, this could have moved this thing along. And I mentioned that to this committee, so that maybe we can spread the word to other commissions that and committees that, when in doubt, use common sense. Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right, any other questions or comments from the public? All right, seeing none, at this point I would accept a motion to approve with the addition of survey locating the erosion protection, installation of half-yard boulders every 10 feet along the disturbed 30-foot line, and removal of the half wall from the 50-foot no build zone.
You have the erosion controls in there as well?
You did?
I did.
Yeah, they're on the plan.
Okay. So moved.
We have a motion. We have a second. We have a motion, a second. Any other discussion?
I just have one question, because I'm sitting here reading the print. It's more my education. What is the limit of reserve
for the septic system?
As far as Title V, we have to show that we have the ability to have a second area.
Oh, okay.
That would
so
be
it's the
essentially
second area. Okay.
Limit of that.
Thank you.
Mounting.
Yep.
Yep.
All right. Any other questions or discussion? The motion is second. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 Thank you.
All right. Thank you. And if you can, prior to us signing, get us an updated plan showing the boulders and the removal of the wall. Make sure that goes in there.
I won't even write the thing until I get that, because I'm going to have to base the order off that plan.
Great. So. Well, just make sure you've got it commented in the minutes, and we can sign at the next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Approve the plan. All right. Moving forward, pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, the Town of Lunenburg Wetlands Protection and Municipal Bylaws, a continued public hearing on a notice of intent by Dan Thomas for work at 183 Hemlock Drive will be held. Work entails installation of a dock, retaining walls, and grading within the 100-foot buffer zone of the wetland resource area.
Mr. Chairman, should it be amended a little bit to also include the retaining walls, but also the essentially the embankment and the wall that was built specifically, if that's considered a retaining wall. I understand the retaining walls are coming uphill further. In this
mm-hmm.
particular case, there was a wall
mm-hmm.
placed in there. I don't know if we want to modify that to clarify that, or it's too late, not a big deal. I'm not sure.
Well, I mean, we would put conditions on
right.
whatever is proposed.
Right.
All right. Did anybody that wanted to get out there and take a look, another look?
I didn't know it was part of the site.
Okay. Well, we had talked about it. That's why we kind of continued it
for
people to take a walk out there to get another look at it. And can I have the file, Matt?
Can I use the DEP phone number you had asked me about?
Yep. Right, so I guess we're continuing our discussion here.
It's an extra.
I have some extra copies of an updated plan that shows dimensions for the deck and erosion placement, erosion barrier placement.
Happen to get any pictures of the wall previously existing?
Yeah, I it should be in the file. The sheet with also with four photographs. That question.
All right, there. You said they were photographs?
Yeah, copies.
There should be a sheet in there with like some photographs.
Yeah. Okay. For some reason, I just don't remember seeing pictures of the old wall before the new wall went in.
No, I don't think there are.
Okay. Yeah, I don't remember seeing. And I thought that was a question I had asked, was do we have any historical pictures of the wall that we're replacing?
Can I see this
one? Sure.
And you're referring to the...
Well, this the wall along the waterfront that was replaced into the lake. Myself, I'd like to see us start addressing some of the...
That shows the wall being here and showing...
Where's the wall?
The wall was in here, but you can see that it was fill placed over
did
here.
We see the...
I
do we have
didn't
pictures?
See the timbers, no, I don't...
Okay.
I'm just saying you can see where the,
yeah,
the old bank was.
Yeah, that was something I had kind of asked for, was do we have pictures of the old wall before we put the new wall up so we know where we're going back to? Assuming there was a wall. If we don't have, if we don't have proof of a wall that was there, the wall's coming out and we're just going to re-vegetate the banking.
Mr. Thomas, when you installed the new wall, did you just cover over the previous wall? So when you excavate those timbers, you took it out?
Yeah.
Okay.
There is one timber there that's remaining.
Right.
That delineated where that wall was located. And that's what we based our measurements from.
Right. So.
That was the one I pointed out during the site.
Yeah, on the east, the east end of the wall. Mm-hmm. Yep.
All right. I've given this some thought, and I'm just going to throw it out there quick. I would... where the water's coming down on the lake, I think we should, of course, moving forward, continue the discussion on the remaining part of this, but I would like to see an enforcement order issued to remove the wall that is currently there. And then get some historical information on what we were replacing, because there is nothing in the file. But we have a limited window on removing the wall that's there.
Right. The drawdown's now in equilibrium on one siphon, and it's probably going to, aside from a little bit of rain, it's
here. But the water's down as far as it's going to go for the next 3 months, and then we'll start coming back up with the water.
Or for sooner, actually, they'll shut the pipe down probably once it starts freezing.
Yeah. But that was a suggestion I was going to put out there.
To separate the wall from the...
Separate the wall from the rest of this, yes, because unfortunately, in looking back, I mean, we have 16 years of permits with very little of the permitted work being done, and then a whole lot of non-permitted or improperly installed work being done.
So, Mr. Chairman, are you talking about this entire wall here? Are you talking about the short wall that was over here? Which wall are you speaking of?
The entire block wall that was placed roughly 2 feet further out in the lake and backfilled. The block wall that the dock's attached to. I just want to try to separate that out from the rest of this.
Sure.
Hashing out, at least so that Mr. Thomas can start on that, because he did say he was looking to get that pulled out.
Mr. Chairman, I'd support that.
Okay.
I would as well. I think it's a great idea to move forward with something.
Yeah, at least with that, because, I mean, we still have discussions on the deck, what other work is trying to be done, things like that.
Mr. Chairman, if we went with pulling out the wall, would we then ask that some sort of a barrier be put up there to keep the erosion from occurring?
Certainly. At this point, I mean, in lieu of showing where there was a wall, the banking should be re-put there, stoned on an angle, naturalized and planted.
Yeah. Okay. I go on that.
But that will give the applicant an opportunity to at least start on that, regardless of the rest of it, and then we can treat that separately. Then I would also like to see that done prior to, if we do approve the rest of the work, see that done prior to anything else being done, because that's a pretty blatant mistake, putting it out there the way he has. And again, to just approve the plan, say, okay, you've got 3 years to do it, and we've got 16 years of stuff not getting done, so.
I mean, I just have to say, too, that my letter to the commission stating my financial situation and so forth...
Yep.
Hasn't changed.
Okay.
So, you know, I'm a one-man show here. And I'd like to, you know, request that this work get done when I can afford to do it, time and money.
You mean as far as which work?
The shoreline wall.
Okay.
It's my understanding that's a dry stack wall?
Yeah.
No mortar? So it would, we're talking labor here?
Lifting the blocks out.
Lifting the blocks out, right?
Mr. Thomas, would you...
So it's when you can afford to do it?
So you're lifting, I mean, it's a good workout, but I think that certainly...
Well, I mean, it's, like I say, it's a matter of time and money. And I have to work, I can't, you know, I'm taking time off to do the wall. I have to pay my mortgage and my bills and...
Well, what schedule of construction did you have, based on your finances and time, if we approve this tonight?
I mean, preferably, I'd like to get it done in the spring.
Get what done?
The wall.
Well, the wall has to come out before the water comes up.
Right.
You can't be taking the wall out and the water's going to be back up. When do they close the dam?
When they shut the siphon down?
Yeah.
Mike, Bob, do you have any sense for that? Are you on the...
Last year, they didn't shut the siphons down until like January.
Yeah.
But that's because we never had an effective frost in the fall.
Yeah.
And the rain didn't cooperate.
Yeah.
So hoping for better results this year.
Okay. My recollection is the...
At most, 2 months.
My recollection is the springtime, the lake's refilled.
Absolutely. You're absolutely correct, Mr. Chairman.
They try to shut him off. There's a concern about even enough water this year, but I believe that probably the first of the year would be the point in which...
Unfortunately, so it doesn't sound like spring's going to, we have to have it out before spring.
And we did defer last time, an agreement earlier, that we would wait until the drawdown.
Yep.
In our meeting, so it's that time.
Mm-hmm.
And so unfortunately, yeah, pulling the wall out, and I suspect that the material, a lot of the material that was covered over is still there.
Yeah.
Yeah, it all came out.
You pulled the stones out, too?
There was a timber wall there.
Yeah, I think it was, some of the edges were still stone, but I don't know.
No.
Yeah. So my feeling is that the wall needs to come out.
Mm-hmm.
It needs to get, something needs to happen.
I support the chairman's efforts here.
And you've got no pictures of the wall prior to this new one going up?
I could probably come up with something.
Okay. Just to give us an idea of, you know, if we're replacing a wall, what we're replacing, because we don't have any pictures of that, so.
I'm not sure what I have, but I'll...
Okay. I mean, we've got pictures back. You know, we've got plenty of pictures, so I'd be surprised if we couldn't come up with one that was showing the wall. So, at that point, where that's going to be our first action, we should probably continue the rest of it.
Yeah.
And see what we can find on pictures and get the wall pulled out. And open any other discussions or suggestions.
It's a good one.
Yeah. Anybody else? Okay.
I also had a question on the commission's concern about permeability, where the proposed deck
mm-hmm.
is going to be rebuilt. I'm not sure what the concern is for that. In other words, you know, I have this tent and shed, you know, full of material, and I also burn with firewood. And I think you noticed that there were some pallets and wood stacked out there to hold the firewood. It was, actually it's between where the proposed deck is and the edge of slope.
Mm-hmm. You're talking about all the debris that was piled there at the top of the slope?
That was over
yep.
the bank.
Yep, you're going to pull that back?
Well,
clean that up.
My whole thought, you know, with the deck
mm-hmm.
was to store firewood underneath.
Yeah.
Shield it with a lattice or, mm-hmm. You know, just, I just find it unsightly.
Yep.
And it would help clean up the lot.
Mm-hmm.
As far as any other storage under there, there might be some framing lumber, but.
Yeah. I guess from my point of view, the 30 foot from the water's edge into that line is called the no disturbance zone. So there's not supposed to be any alterations in that area, which we have plenty of disturbance. We have stuff piled everywhere. So, I mean, from my point of view, we're looking to get that cleaned up and sure. naturalized as best we can. Putting a deck with proposed walls and storage and things like that underneath kind of defeats the purpose of the 30-foot no disturbance zone. Myself, I speak for myself, not for everybody, but so I think that was one of the discussions in not having stuff stored under the deck.
Yeah.
Was to stop that from happening. You know, try to get all the storage and stuff up back away from the water, get the water's edge cleaned up, get the erosion cleaned up. You know, we had railroad ties in there that are leaching creosote and who knows what else. So,
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
If and when we were to consider the deck further,
mm-hmm.
From my point of view, it would be a precondition that before work on the deck could start, that we'd be removing the shed and the tent because they're not supposed to be there. And given the length of time this has gone on, I think that that's the only way we can be sure they'll disappear. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I agree with you, Mr. Chairman. I think, you know, we've put that everything else except that wall off, but I would be remiss if I didn't reinforce what you said. I mean, to begin with, you know, we're being asked to build a structure in the 30-foot no-touch, so I'm not sure if, you know, and it was permitted in the past, but I don't think that counts anymore. So I think that it takes a lot more discussion and really understanding, you know, why we would do it, why would it be at all, why would it be that big, and all of the details. So
mm-hmm.
there's a lot more work to do on that deck.
All right, so...
You're referring to the deck?
The deck.
Yep.
All right, so I guess I would suggest, open to opinions, at this point, issue the enforcement order for removal of the wall, and pending proof of what was there and location, renaturalize the entire bank once that is removed, back to the location where it was, back, pull it back about 3 feet. I would start there and ask the applicant to continue the application on the rest of the work until we get this work done, and then start moving forward with the rest of it.
So, Mr. Chairman, to clarify, if the applicant comes in with evidence of where the previous wall was, would we be open to allowing him to move that wall, essentially move that back 2 feet?
Rebuild it back to where it was.
Rather than, you know, to have to do it twice, you just do it once and... Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Yep.
But, yeah, to at least get started with that, I mean, we've been dragging along here for a while now.
Agreed.
That would be my suggestion, and if you can have some pictures to show us what you had, where we're putting it back to, we can amend the enforcement order at that point, but at this point, issue the enforcement order that the wall's removed, the bankings are renaturalized and planted in the scope timeframe of the drawdown, so that this work is completed.
Right.
And without it being completed, we'll just start fines.
Yeah, December 31 would be reasonable, be year end.
I was thinking January 1st, but yeah, that was the timeframe.
When the water starts coming back up.
So...
I mean, it's a little hard if you're just closing the gates January 1st. If everything's frozen, you don't have a lot of water flow, he might still be able to work in there in January, early February. So I was going to say probably February 28th as the cutoff, assuming that the water is still out. Once the water comes in...
I would somehow tie that in. I know it's a floating...
I would like to see us have a date before February 28th. I think that's dragging it out too long.
Okay.
Because the water could come back up. I wouldn't want someone to come in here and say, I can't do it now because the water's back up.
Yep.
You know, we should get this done this year. It's gone on a long time.
So January, so we'll propose January 1st. Okay. That'll give you a couple months to pull that out. And then if you could, in the interim, come up with some pictures on what's there while the water's down, if you wanted to put it back in. If not, while it's out, revegetate the banking and try again when the water's down next year to put it back. Okay?
Yep.
All right, so I'll accept a motion to issue an enforcement order on 183 Hemlock Drive for removal of improperly placed wall within the floodplain and the basin of Hickory Hills, and possible replacement with proof of existing wall dimensions and size and location. If not, the banking will be renaturalized and vegetated.
And continuing until the December 7th meeting.
And continuing this at least until the December 7th. Unless somebody, myself, I'd like to continue that until the ending date of the enforcement order, which would be January.
Okay.
Yeah, I would agree.
Take it one step at a time.
Yep.
Okay.
So, when do you want me here back here then?
Well, ultimately by January 1st, showing that the wall's been removed. If you do come up with pictures showing that the wall was there where it was, I'll talk with Matt to get it.
Okay.
Get it marked. I mean, if you have it there, at least get it to Matt so Matt can forward it out to us. And then we can reschedule or convene just a quick site walk. Then you can just show us where it was and where we're putting it.
So our first meeting would be January 4th.
Okay.
And if you find something, come on in earlier.
Yeah, definitely stay in contact with Matt on that to get it out to everybody.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, the timing is kind of concerning me a little bit here, because if we go into January, the wall is removed for our order, but the new wall hasn't been started being constructed. In January, you may be in a situation where you can't do anything. And now we've got a bad situation. The lake comes up, it erodes. You know, it's not stabilized. So just concerned about that disconnect between, you know, we end up with something that's removed but not stabilized, and the water comes up.
Well, at that point, we'll just have to put in erosion protection, staked hay bales, or the cocoa liner mats like they use on the lake, on the islands.
Yeah.
So some sort of erosion protection will be needed.
I would encourage the applicant to...
I mean, I'm thinking positive.
Right away, so we can just move and just get it all done, because it'll be quite a problem to stabilize it.
Location of the wall, when the boards are out of the dam, the natural drawdown, there's still room to walk in front of the existing wall, so, you know.
Well, obviously, the water comes up, because we've got pictures of the water up the wall.
When you put the boards back in, you know.
Yeah, you're in the water, building a wall.
And if you have trouble finding photographic evidence of the previous wall, there might be some remnants of ties along there, behind there, you might say, you know.
Still there.
So when you get into it, you might be able to just say, hey, here's some ties, take some pictures, and that would suffice for me.
That would be great, yeah.
Okay.
All right, so with your permission, we'll continue this hearing to January 4th. So first, we'll move on to enforcement order. As I listed it out, I'll accept a motion to issue that.
So moved.
We have a motion, we have a second.
Second.
All right, any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 All right, and with the applicant's permission, we'll continue the notice of intent until January 4th. I'll accept a motion.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 All right, but yeah, definitely stay in contact with Matt. That's mine. And if we can get... And this was the updated one?
Want to get a dimension on it?
Yep.
Can I just get you...
I don't know if there's a date on that showing, or...
No, if you can sign and date those for us. Just make sure those are the new ones. Yeah, and just give them a pen, Matt.
That's the old one.
Okay.
There's a new one.
Okay, then just give us the new one, Matt. I don't need the old one. Or just sign and date the new one.
Here's a pen. Sorry, use a pen.
And if you just stamp it received tomorrow.
Yeah, I'll mark them.
Yep. And the same with any pictures that you present, sign and date the backs of them, please.
What is the date?
Today is the 16th. All right. I appreciate that.
You want more than one copy?
If you had a second, that would be great.
Yeah.
You had passed a bunch out.
Yeah.
I don't think I butchered this too.
Yep, perfect.
Have to get one to the Lake Association, too.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, and a good night. All right, if there is no vetoes, I was going to move down to 338 Sunset, where the gentleman is here.
Okay.
And this is an enforcement action here.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to recuse myself.
Okay. All right, we did go out on Saturday, had a quick walk around.
Okay.
It's a big house.
Decent size.
Yeah, all right. So we had talked previously about the wall.
Yes.
Now that the water's down, you're going to take the wall apart and slope it.
Yeah, recreate it. We're actually going to kind of move it down the shoreline as well to kind of...
Mm-hmm. Okay, but yeah, I mean, use the rocks to put in along the water's front to protect it and stop the erosion.
Yeah, so it's about 90 degrees.
Yeah. And it should stop it, you know, wherever the ground comes down to it.
Yep.
So unfortunately... We've already gone over this.
It was a difficult situation with that retaining, that railroad tie wall.
Yep.
If you're standing in the property to the left.
Yep.
That was severely eroded in there, you know, over the years and years.
Yep, yep, but that didn't, I can see a little bit of, you know, a little bit on this side needing to be done.
Yeah, but the rest of it, yeah.
Kept going, so unfortunately, that's not what we discussed.
That nice Scotch pine that we're hoping to save, that we did build that out to try and.
Okay.
And I mean, I really beat in a lot of soil. That was, I have a picture of a shovel. I actually fit a whole shovel underneath that system of that tree, so.
Okay.
I'm trying my best to save that tree. It's a beautiful tree.
All right, so we did notice, so moving on that, that was a past item. We just want to make sure now the water's down. You're planning to get back out there in the next month or so.
Yeah, we're trying to get a lot done before the frost comes, but yeah, that's on the list. So I'm hoping to get it done Thanksgiving week.
Okay, yeah, because I mean, that's limited because you can't do that in the summertime, so we just want to make sure that that is going to get repaired.
Oh, yeah, no, definitely before the.
Okay.
Yeah, December will be done.
We walked out there and there seems to be quite a bit of grading and tree work that was done outside of the limit of work that we had set on the plan.
Okay.
And unfortunately, at this point, without seeing exactly what has been done, it's kind of hard to come up with what we need to fix. So when we were out on site, Matt had suggested having your engineer in the next couple of weeks present us with an as-built as of today to see where.
Is that going to be required for your compliance certificate?
Well, the as-built would be required anyways, but.
The as-built, once everything's done.
Yeah, but we.
Right, but what we're asking to do is to do it now, so because it appears that there's been some work that is outside of the scope of what was approved. So the engineer can mark the erosion protection where everything was cut in so we can compare it to what we originally approved, just to make sure everything.
Okay.
You know, where were the trees cut down, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah, and the grading and things like that.
The grading.
I mean, the most obvious one, and it just kind of ended the discussion on what's changed, was your limit of work was 3 feet from the wellhead. That banking's been cut back 40 feet from the wellhead. So, I mean, just there alone.
Do we have the plans with us tonight?
Actually,
do you have the file, Matt?
I do have it on the file.
Yeah, I mean,
I guess it would be easy if, you know, if you do a site walk and.
Well, we did the site walk, so now we just kind of want it on paper. The difference between what was approved and what's there now is the problem. You know, we go out to this wellhead. The wellhead right here. Well, you've cut that banking back to about here, away from that wellhead.
There is a decent amount of fill that's taken out of there now.
There is, correct.
But
so that wasn't approved though.
I mean, the silt fence is placed where it is on the plan, and it's kind of regraded.
I don't think so.
It's pretty close. I mean, that silt fence is, if you measure from the wellhead, it goes back probably, what, 30, 40 feet?
10.
10?
10, yeah.
The silt fence?
Sure. That's the wellhead. That's a silt fence.
Oh, I'm looking
this
at
is a 30-foot buffer right here.
30-foot buffer, yeah.
So, I mean,
yeah.
Your limit of work is right here. You've cut back that banking way back here. You've got grading all in here, so.
Maybe I'm looking at it wrong. Yeah, that silt fence isn't even marked. That's marked a lot differently than the plan that I have, to tell you the truth. The plan that I have, the silt fence comes wraps around here.
And then it
doesn't come to the water here. It actually loops around.
Yeah, I actually like have this one here, which still has it in the same spot.
Oh, okay.
10 feet away.
Okay.
There's the wellhead. There's your erosion protection.
I gotcha.
That's 30 feet, so, and you've cut into that banking. That's why we want the engineer to reshoot this, reshoot the grades to see what we've got to put back. You know, they've been grading all down in through here in the 30 foot, then grading down in here, tree removal.
Yeah. We've seen extensive tree removal outside of it. We have all sorts of pictures to validate. Also, with regard to the
thanks.
Beach is
down here.
Right here.
This is a no-touch zone. That was all, it's all sand.
That was, the sand was there.
Well, additionally, a lot of the sand is now on your beach, and is now migrating further south, and this, it's not consistent with the soil that I'm, so obviously, it looks to us as we're down. Additionally, some tree stumps that were, there's some large trees inside the 30-foot that were taken down. We have pictures of the stumps, and now we also have pictures that have been covered over. So you've moved other soils down there, here as well.
Okay.
Okay, we've got a lot of pictures. We Google.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, but that's, and I, that's gonna be the request to at least start, is get the, as conditions today, a conditions plan, so we can see where we are compared to where we're supposed to be.
So you want Whitman to go out and shoot an as-built?
Shoot an as-built.
I think, Mr. Chairman, if we could go out and make another site visit to get an assessment of how many trees were, whether it was 20 or 30.
Well, let's get the as-built first, and then, because that's the...
I mean, at least my understanding when we talked a year ago...
July 14th, 2015.
Was, yeah.
That those, I could take two trees within the 30-foot no-touch, right?
You know, we can review it, like I say, once we get the as-built...
I mean, a lot of it, we just kind of discussed.
The last time we discussed it was last May, and the minutes say that Brad and I went in, and there were two trees, 5 feet within the 30-foot that were taken out at the time. That's what the two trees were about.
That were already taken out, right.
That we stumped.
Yeah, but there's still, again, there's a lot...
So that's why that soil was...
Yeah, but there's a...
I guess kind of disturbed.
Well, sitting in, there's a, there's probably another 20 trees that have been removed.
Oh, there's no way. No, I took three, maybe.
You wanna pull the pictures up?
Yeah, I'd love to see them.
Go ahead, Matt.
Yeah, I'm not, I'm, no, let's just, for now, instead of just rehashing it, why don't we get the as-built in front of us?
You know, pictures, so that we could... Prepare for the meeting, but...
So the tire of that backhoe is where your wellhead is.
Yeah.
And that's how far back you've taken that hill. And the road, and your limit of work was 10 feet from the front of that backhoe. So that's the minimum of 40 feet encroached that you've done that was not approved.
But I mean, I guess I'm maybe a little flipped around on the lot, but...
Yeah.
I mean, that is right in that area. This one's a little easier for me. This is, I'm not sure what happened. So the tire of that backhoe is...
That backhoe is sitting right here. The backhoe itself is sitting right here.
Oh, okay.
So your limit of work is here at this wellhead.
Yeah.
So you've cut back that banking to here. And removed all those trees. It's graded down around here, down around here. So what is there now? You've taken all of this out.
Okay.
So we need to see what the grades are now, so we can figure out how we're going to put it back to the way it was supposed to be.
I mean, this area of sand right here was taken out probably in the last couple of weeks. And there's more to get in there, but that bank had to come down to get a well truck to put the well there.
Well, if this is
just
your limit of work,
if you look at the elevation here, it's...
But again, if that's your proposed limit of work, how you get it done was your responsibility.
Okay.
We approved the limit of work as this.
Okay. So I guess that's where my misunderstanding was. That is, it's 30-foot no-touch, so I just kind of extended the silt fence out into that 30-foot area. And then the 50-foot no build, like I didn't build anything in that 50-foot area, so.
Yeah, but this is your limit of work as you're getting out in here, so it's not work that was.
So I guess that was my misunderstanding, so.
Okay.
I essentially just had the well guy go out, how far, I need a flat space to get a big truck in there, and I said, okay, so let's.
Yeah, so that your erosion protection's not where it's supposed to be. The work is outside of the limit of work. So at this point, to see what's been done, so we're not guessing.
Yeah.
We have something in writing, and then we can sit down and review what we need to do to get back to what was approved.
Okay.
All right.
The pictures, just so you know, the pictures that were being referred to, I just got this.
Oh, you just, okay. Okay.
Yeah, so we need to get back to where we're supposed to be.
Sounds like one more search to me yesterday, and I discovered my email because I was out sick.
Oh, okay, yeah, that's, okay. And again, I thought it was for retaining, I don't know, for, and again, I thought we were well within our, like, the 30-foot silt fence.
Yep.
And again, one of these plans, I don't even recognize them. I don't know, they're dated the same date, so.
Yeah, which is fine, I mean, we'll go off of what's approved, and then.
Just so I can kind of foresee a little further into the future.
Yep.
I mean, it, that 30-foot silt fence has been there for a year.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't brought up when that silt fence inspection took place.
Yeah.
I guess, could that have maybe prevented some of the, I mean, again, that's my misunderstanding of what I could and couldn't do, but I kind of set the silt fence, and then it was, okay, so the silt fence is that work area.
Well, the silt fence says is on the plan.
But the silt fence was inspected by conservation after it was built.
Okay.
And it was agreed that that was the work area, if I'm not mistaken.
Again, what was approved is what's on the plan, so.
Yeah, but again, it was my mistake, thinking, you know, it's a 30-foot no-touch and a 50-foot no-build, so I put a silt fence on a 30-foot line, I mean, you can measure to the inch, it's 30 feet.
Okay.
So, I guess, that's kind of where, if I can't see into the future, what, like, what would need to be done, I mean.
Yeah, I would refer back to the plan, and that's what you should be using, and your contractor should be using, is, you know, the grades are on the plan, the erosion protection's on the plan, the limit of work is on the plan.
Okay.
What can be done.
Regrade that hill and.
We'll end up, yeah, we'll definitely end up having to regrade the hill, put the plantings, you know.
Put some plantings back in.
Yeah, Whitman and Bingham can just do a quick survey on the site.
We actually have, I'm not sure, there's a bunch of stones on site.
Yeah.
And we were gonna kind of put a natural stepping, kind of, not stepping, but.
Let's, at this point, let's get the as-built, and then we can go.
Well, maybe I can put it in on a plan that Whitman and Bingham.
If you have ideas, have them put it in as a layer, certainly, and bring it forward.
So, yeah, I'm trying to see a little future, so we can kind of kill two birds with one stone here. So if I propose, like, putting some stones for retaining.
Yep.
And some shrubs and bushes and trees in that area again.
Just make sure they.
That's what we do have planned.
Yeah, make sure they demarcate.
This big caved-in area.
Yeah, just make sure they demarcate that as proposed.
Okay.
Because we, first off, we have to get it back to what was approved.
Yeah.
Then anything above and beyond approved, you have to get an amendment for, so.
Okay.
Okay?
I know it sounds like a lot, but I think if you actually get this stuff spelled out in a plan.
Yeah, and again.
Then we're all looking at the same thing, so.
Because right now, we're all trying to imagine it in our heads, and.
But I think what you're imagining in your head is what we're actually gonna do, so.
Right, but I'm saying, it's just, be seeing things differently.
The contractor did take probably five loads more than, that's.
Well, as you can tell.
It was a guy that said, can I take some fill, and I said, yeah, sure.
Yeah, I mean, we're pretty sensitive to that area, that was a really sensitive spot to begin with, so.
Fill that needs to come out where the septic is gonna go.
Mm-hmm.
So we're taking all that natural fill from where the septic area, we had to fill it in to get concrete checks and everything back there, so we're taking about six tractor trailer loads of fill out of that septic area.
Yep.
Bringing the septic sand in, and all of that fill has to go back into that hill.
Yeah.
So it's.
You didn't tell us that to begin with, so.
No, but that was my misunderstanding.
Yep, no problem.
I gotta get a truck in there, okay, let's get a truck in there.
Yep.
The silt fence stayed on the 30-foot no-touch.
All right, yeah, so let's get the plan done, and then we can, if you give Matt a quick call when you get it, then we can schedule to sit down and look at it.
I think it was 20 trees, it might have, on that hill at least, and they were outside 30-foot.
I didn't do it in exact count, but.
It was probably three.
All right, let's move forward.
Sorry.
Okay, yeah, we've got other business, so. If you can just contact Matt when you get the as-built, and then we can keep discussing it.
So is, like, if you have pictures of that hillside before it was disturbed, that would be really helpful in that discussion moving forward as well. Yeah, I can bring you a picture, but, I mean, it's tough to tell. I mean, that will just.
It's tough to tell where you're at.
I'm thinking in the future in the discussion with, you know, trees and density and that sort of, that'd be helpful to have if you have it.
Okay.
I tried to go back to, with Google, all I have is the most current one, actually.
It's got the backhoe sitting there.
It's got the backhoe right in the middle of it, yeah, I know.
Yeah, it looks like a month ago.
Yeah.
So, okay.
Yep.
All right.
I think we'll be, I think you're gonna be very happy with what we do, so.
Okay, yeah, unfortunately, it's just a visible spot, and.
Yeah.
It is sensitive, so.
It's a nice one right now.
Yep.
All right, this is actually under, the signature's in under old business. I've got 56 Cross Street. We reissued an order of conditions that they promptly can't find. And I think what may have happened is sometimes the mail for Cross Street gets sent to Cross Ave.
Cross Road.
Cross Road, rather. So I've got two copies of an order to reissue for the Brockmans. They're going to come pick it up by hand.
What's the date?
The date, they've got an extension, they've got a valid extension permit, actually.
What was the date it was issued?
It was issued, the date should be in there. The issue date should be on the order.
All the dates are the 16th.
Oh, okay, that's the reissue. July 2009.
Oh, this is for their pond. I was going to say, that's the only thing I could remember them being in for.
No, we gave an extension permit to them.
Okay.
And then when we went to record the extension permit, they realized their order was never recorded. So we reissued the order, and then they couldn't find the reissue because I had mailed it to them, so it may have gone to the other cross.
Okay.
Like a cross in the mail.
Wait a second. Just a question. My neighbor came over.
You mean this neighbor?
Mr. King? Mr. King? Oh, thank you. That's a perfect thing. Thank you.
Yeah, I got a reissue for Larry King, not the talk show host.
I don't
thank you for the tabs.
Is he?
Yes.
Yeah.
The tabs are
signed at the tabs.
Yeah.
Thank you, man.
I just got to reprint his front page because I just noticed I spelled Townsend Harbor Road with my usual dyslexic flair.
I won't have to dodge him anymore. Thank you.
You do know I am mildly dyslexic, so every once in a while I'll switch letters.
Sure.
Reading charts is a lot of fun, you know? Yeah.
We have a couple Novembers in Brockmans, too.
Couple of what?
Novembers.
Okay, yeah, see.
All right.
Usually before I issue these, I go over every single word just to make sure.
Yeah.
And if it's on, you know, one of the pages, I just reprint it. This is the certificate of compliance for 64 Chestnut Street. I have a site inspection report on file, and there is a complete as-built showing it was done in accordance with the order.
What did we do at 64 Chestnut?
The replacement of a septic system.
Is that across the street from the funeral home?
No, it's right by the baseball field.
Okay. Just trying to
I think that's, what's the name? Is that Roy, Greg Roy's house?
No. This one is the White House, then you've got the ponded area right by the field, and then you've got the field.
Okay. No.
But Greg's was across the street from the field. Okay. What else we have?
Mr. Masso's order of conditions.
I voted no.
The amended order for Steve Violet, Lancaster Ave. Basically, I just retyped the original order and put in the dates of the new plans. They did start putting the hay bales out on that site this morning. Saw them out with the bales, and Mr. Christopher was actually out making sure the bales were done and right where they were on the plans. I could see him with, like, measuring tape. And
they are very conscientious.
That was early. That was like 7:30. The crack of dawn, they were out there.
That it?
The Petersons over on Gilchrist Street.
Okay.
And one thing I would note, like, on this one, the condition 45 on the town boiler, as agreed, the barn and the goat pen will be placed outside the 50-foot no-structure zone and coop be placed outside the 30-foot no-touch zone. There will be addition of the erosion planning and 30 and 50 foot offsets added to the plan approved to be approved by the administrator. Mr. Christopher submitted those the next day.
Okay. You approved them, I assume?
Yeah, he did a good job, actually. Did a very good job.
And that's it. And last but not least, that's it. All right, moving forward, do you have a report for 190 Electric Ave, 225 Pleasant Street, the stream on the town property?
Yeah, actually, Ryan Smith was awarded the bid, and I'm waiting for coordination between him and Mr. Rowe to start the work. So I reminded Adam today about that, and he was going to contact Mr. Rowe to open some more.
Okay. Yeah, just because this does expire on the 21st, so hopefully at our next meeting, we can just close it out. 189 Howard?
189 Howard, I'm asking that on our next site inspection, we go out and take a look at that.
Okay.
I'd like for the commission to see what's been done so far and what could be done to continue to facilitate the correction.
Is it done to the neighbor's satisfaction?
Not totally. There were other items that I needed taken care of. I haven't been able to get back there to see if he's done that yet.
All right, let's see if we can get that closed out for winter. How much work is left to do?
There really isn't that much. It's just a matter of getting everybody on gear to do it.
All right, now let's make that a priority if we can, where we're blessed with some temperate weather right now. Ruth Street?
I'm just waiting. It may be a while, but I'm waiting for them to get back to me from the deed restriction. The deed restriction was done.
Okay. How are we doing on the vegetation?
Vegetation's already done. That was done a while ago.
Okay, so it's grown back to the water line? Okay. So we're just waiting on the deed restriction. 121 Pleasant?
121 Peninsula, as I had mentioned to you earlier in the meeting, I'm working with the owner on a notice of intent.
Okay. So we should have that for the 3rd of December?
7th, you mean?
7th of December, so we can see it on the 3rd.
Mm-hmm.
43 Island.
43 Island, Mr. Paroli is having Mr. Hannigan refile the NOI. I haven't heard from Mr. Hannigan yet.
Okay. Let's give him a little poke, if we can. If we don't have some communication, we should probably have an administrative hearing on that.
Mm-hmm.
Because they've had plenty of time to be moving forward. 338 Sunset, they're going to give us an as-built. We can continue that discussion. Ford Stewardship Grants, Adam has advertised the RFQ.
Yep, that's it.
Hollis Road Habitat, Kenny told us about that.
I do have one more thing on that.
Yeah.
We wanted to get that planting done prior to winter for some seeding that we were going to do. I talked to a local contractor that has some equipment that can get that area tilled up, so he's going to be working on that, and he was actually going to potentially donate some of the seed and stuff.
Okay.
Too. So that's going forward, and I'll coordinate with Matt as far as that goes.
So
that's moving forward.
Holman Street, there's no Tom tonight,
but I can tell you the bridge, all the footbridges are done.
Yeah.
And the main bridge over the Mulpus, the deck is up, is installed.
Really? What do we end up using for beams?
Six telephone poles.
Six telephone poles?
Yeah.
Didn't use the struts at all.
Steel wasn't going to make it.
Yeah.
Which is too bad. It would have been a nice historical monument, even if you took a couple and screwed to it.
It's a very impressive structure.
Is it? You have any pictures?
Pictures on Facebook.
Are there? Okay.
On the steward of conservation or whatever.
Okay.
But it did look good from
what
I saw.
Can you pull a few of those pictures off of Facebook and see if maybe we can have one or two of them posted on our website?
Sure.
Check with Steve on that.
Yeah, that's easy enough.
See if he can put a picture.
It's easy enough.
If it's an impressive bridge.
Well, it'll be even more impressive when it's done. You know, it's nowhere near done yet, but the deck is up, and it's an impressive structure.
Is it? Okay, yeah.
They did a fabulous job.
Yeah, if you can get something up there, just so people can see it. Woodlands, action items.
Woodlands expects to submit a RDA probably January or February.
Okay. How are we doing on our recordings? You said everything for 2016 has been recorded.
Yep.
And working back on 2015.
Working back on 15, 14, 13.
Okay.
It just continues.
And I know you did get one correspondence from Alan Foster, whose order was running out. Have you received anything from the others?
He's going to be sending me an extension request.
Okay.
I gave him a deadline as to when it needed to be in by.
Okay.
In fact, the certificate you signed off for Chestnut Street was a result of those efforts.
Oh, good.
In getting the ASBIL.
Okay.
And it was kicking in.
Keep working back on that. And what do we have for our December 7th hearing for new applications? I know we've got a few continuances.
I've got items that are coming in. I've got about three of them. One I got in today was a, was Bob Proctor for an E1 system over on 4 Sunset Ave. So that'll be, that's already slated. I already put the legal out on that. I've got one coming in from National Grid for a gas line, and I've got one coming in from 79 Brookview for an addition. That's a notice of intent.
So they will be on the December 7th?
They will be on.
So you've had...
Because next week is the deadline, because we have that overlapping week.
Oh, we have an extra week for advertising, right?
Right, so, you know, I've got, actually, Mr. Al Patnode, who was the building representative for the Bulls, is doing the Brookview one.
Okay.
He's done everything, he's done a nice scale drawing, he's done everything quite well, so he's going to be finishing that up and turning that in.
Okay.
For the deadline. And that's it so far, other than the continuances.
All right, budget? Adjustment for advertising?
Yeah, I had to put in a transfer for our advertising budget, because we've had so many hearings, we blew through our ad money.
Okay.
Even with the ledger. So I put in for that.
Okay.
I'm going to be working with Adam on the next budget to look at establishing, using the $300 they give us as seed money, and establishing the payments people give us for the ads to go right to a revolving account. So the money is always rotating. So we never, we wind up using the money they give us directly instead of putting it into the general fund and then getting an appropriation later.
Now, the applicants pay for their advertising, but the check goes right to the general fund, and then we have to pay for the advertising out of our budget. So just if we can keep that rotating, they pay for the ad, as opposed to keep having to go back for more. Any other action items? Yes?
On that point, and we can discuss it when it gets budget time, which is going to be very soon, I think we should have a discussion about how we run this, and because according to the state, we're supposed to actually keep all the fees, advertising, all of these fees, and essentially have our own budget.
And that issue's been raised multiple times.
Well, I'm raising it again, because we still don't, I still haven't heard any good discussion of why we wouldn't do that.
Well, the feeling is our income is not equal to our budget. So if we push the issue to have our income placed in a revolving fund, our budget will be cut appropriately, so that we will have the same monies.
But you wouldn't be having this discussion, because the advertising would be in our budget and would come in, and we would more than pay for advertising, because we don't spend as much for advertising as we charge people.
Well, it's supposed to be about even.
That's not true anymore, because the ledger's doubled their prices.
What do we pay for advertising?
They pay for about $40 an ad, and we're paying about $40 an ad now.
But we have three or four ads in one thing. You're saying we're paying $160 for that thing we run in the ledger?
I'm paying, well, it's a little less than 160. It's almost like 100.
Yeah, so I suspect it's still a net positive. But I mean, I don't know all the pros and cons of doing this, or if we've ever looked into them, but when the state says you have to go do something special to turn your money over to the town, it tells me, gives me a message that there probably are some good reasons that they would do that, and that they would have the money stay with the commission.
I think that was to give them a guaranteed source of funding. If the town didn't give you any budget, at least you had something. So at this point, we have more than we, because I got the reports last year from Jan for the last 4 years, and our budget's 60-something thousand dollars.
Yeah, budget is actually very good.
But that includes the salary of the...
Yes.
I got to be honest, I've actually worked for commissions that have the NOI funds, and you still run into problems with line items running out.
Yeah, so we can discuss a little bit more, because we should put that in either on the 7th or on the 21st to discuss the budget, so we have it in place before we get to that time frame anyways. So, but we can continue that. And we do have a workshop to work on bylaw and regulations on November 30th, so that will be an off-hearing night. We have no hearings. No hearings will be scheduled that night.
Mr. Chairman, I hope you hold to that. The last time we had a workshop, a meeting, we came in and we actually had a hearing that night. So, well, I'm not sure if it was a hearing, but we discussed, we had an applicant there and we discussed it, and it took up, you know, probably 30, 40 minutes of the meeting. So I hope this next meeting will be reserved strictly for workshop.
Yep.
Thank you.
Chairman, so strictly for workshop on the 30th. Actually, we'll be downstairs. We'll have the monitors set up, so, because that worked out really well.
Mr. Chairman, specific to the workshop, we had some discussions that came up again tonight with regard to amending the requirements for an applicant specific to staking out the property, staking out where the pieces were going to go.
Yep.
You know, when we said we should be adding that, can we make that part of the workshop and potentially?
Well, Matt and I have developed a checklist of information that is paramount to accepting an application.
Okay, so
he has added the staking to that checklist.
Will we vote to approve that then?
Well, it's just a, it's just an office procedure.
Okay.
So.
So we wouldn't need that.
Nope, so he'll just add that to the checklist of information that's needed prior to it. I mean, it's information we need anyways, so we might as well have it prior to the first hearing, so that we don't have to continually continue.
Prior to the sidewalk.
Yes, exactly, prior to sidewalk, yeah.
Sidewalk. And the other thing was the brilliant idea that we start giving RDA's numbers.
Mm-hmm. I think he's already implemented that.
Part of that? Okay, awesome.
That was listed on the first two RDAs that we signed tonight, had their numbers.
And under the finding of fact, they put a requirement that a sign bearing that number be posted as long as the work's being done.
Brilliant. Excellent.
No, thank him for it. That was his idea.
All right.
I thought it was a great idea when he said it.
I mean, the old guys have good ideas.
The light bulb went off. I'm like, wow, that's a pretty good idea.
Yep.
That's a great idea.
If I could fill in that thought, though, both of those thoughts. And I'd be willing to do the work, but I think for some of these things, we should have some documentation, and not necessarily in regulation, but a policy. Somewhere written down, other than on the top of a form, you know, we, you know. I really appreciate you moving so quick on that idea, but we probably should have a little more process, you know, of, you know, discussion, agreement, and then writing it down as a policy. Because like even the staking, you know, we put on a checklist, next thing you know, the checklist's gone, and the applicant's saying, well, I didn't see that requirement. Right. It's not a requirement anywhere. So I'm thinking maybe we could collect some things that just...
Yeah, and those are things as we get into the regulations we can add, you know, add it so that there's a historical noting of it.
But it's a little more tough to do.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it is part of the application that we do hand out now, so it goes to every applicant. There's one checklist for RDAs, one checklist for NOIs, which we already had one in place, but over time, like you said, they just kind of fell out. We ran out of paper one day and we didn't print it. And
so it becomes a little, if you don't have a process, it becomes too easy to undo it.
Yeah.
You know, let's have a new checklist. Cross that off.
Yep. Understood. And we can go over that a little more on the 30th.
Yep, good.
So, all right. Any other questions or comments? Any public comment?
There's no reports.
Public left. For reports?
I wasn't looking for a report. Anybody looking for a report? Do we have minutes to approve?
Oh, there was one, right?
I haven't seen.
Yes, the November 2nd was mailed out.
Yep, it was mailed out. It was sent out.
Yeah, I have it.
I move we approve the minutes as modified by the clerk.
Okay. Okay. We have a motion. We have a second.
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 Do we any discussion? All those in favor of approving the minutes, say aye.
Aye.
All right.
Who seconded?
Everybody.
Everybody did.
Carl. Just Carl seconded. All right. Any other public comment?
I just make one comment. Stormwater reminded me, and I had to bring Phyllis back from this training thing she went to, so I had to hear about stormwater. It made me think, it was earlier when we talked about Lancaster with the, you know, Christopher doing the whatever that thing's called. We went from swale to detention. The only thing that bothers me there that I'd like to suggest we think about is the maintenance requirement. Now, it was asked, and the answer, and, you know, and Mr. Christopher is very, you know, reliable, thorough person, but he's not. You know, the answer that the contractor is going to remind the owner when it needs to be cleaned, I don't think is a good
it's a good process. So I just like to suggest in the future that, you know, we require a maintenance plan, you know, and not just a good intention that we're going to keep an eye on it. Because it's worthless without maintenance, you know. 10 years, it ain't going to be doing its job. So it just concerned me, and I just wanted to...
I think at least in that case, requirement of the maintenance plan was exempt where it was an agricultural venture. He did bring that up. That wasn't his report.
Mostly, I mean, actually, on all the subdivisions, we do require maintenance management plans.
But we do, yeah.
It's part of the stormwater system.
But they're never enforced, though, are they?
And that's something that, now that we have a full-time administrator, Matt and Adam, we're going to start reviewing that.
One of the projects I had been talking to Adam about was actually inspecting all the stormwater systems that we have, regardless of whether there was a commission order or not.
Right.
Considering I have experience inspecting these stormwater systems, put it to use.
No, I think that's important.
Come up with a database of them, because a fair amount of them we don't even see.
Right.
Because they're outside of our jurisdiction.
They're regulated by the planning board or whatever.
Exactly, yeah. That's why he's going to work with the planning director to get a database and start reviewing the maintenance.
That's been maintained probably once since.
And that was because Marion sent me down to Bark Avenue.
No, I know, yeah.
Yep.
But that just is the biggest one I can think of.
Should have seen the trees I had him take out of those D-basins. Unbelievable. The grease traps were plugged solid. It was just, it was fun. Not really.
Grease trap?
Hmm?
Did you say grease trap?
Yeah. Behind Walmart.
Yeah, I know it. Well.
Had them suck that baby right out.
Good.
And I actually sat there and babysat him while he did it. It was not fun day.
We appreciate that.
All right, so any other questions or comments? Yes?
I had a question about evidence that, or testimony or evidence that the commission gets outside of the public hearing, you know, like for an RDA or an enforcement. I mean, is it okay for us to consider evidence, or should we, you know, if we get, you know, like an email about an application, and it's not presented in the public hearing, that that's okay.
If someone sends you an email personally?
No, they send it like to everyone on the commission. I just.
Could you give it like a hypothetical example, just because I can't get it.
Let's say we had a commission member who was interested, particularly interested in a particular application, and sent everybody on the commission an email, okay, with their stating, you know, their point of view on it, you know, just as a concerned citizen, hypothetical, you know, and so now the commission's all seen that, but it hasn't been discussed, you know, at the public hearing. I'm just asking, is that okay? If that's okay, that's great. If it's, I just don't understand the process. You know, in Connecticut, when I was on the Planning and Zoning Commission, you had a public hearing. And if it didn't happen in the public hearing, it wasn't evidence. And you know, but that was Connecticut, it's a different set of laws, and there's a lot of court case law, you know, around decisions in zoning regulations in Connecticut. But I don't know, and I'm just asking about, you know, what the situation is in Massachusetts as it pertains to conservation commissions.
Well, at least anything sent to a commissioner or the commission's, because we all have our Lunenburg online emails,
right.
Those are all public records. So as far as discussing them in a hearing, yeah, if somebody wants to present it, if nobody presents it, then nobody's presented it.
We have had hearings where we've received letters and they've been read.
They've been
in
read.
The record.
Yep.
So.
Yeah, essentially, the way the law works is if a commissioner has an opinion on a hearing and has information or evidence that they've discovered that they want to make sure is presented, they do have the right to present it informationally to the rest of the commission. What can't happen is that the commissioners start hitting reply buttons and start talking about it either prior to the hearing or in between during the continuance.
So what I hear you saying is that it's okay.
It's okay.
That it's fine.
If it's informational purposes.
It's fine. Yeah.
If you send something into the commission saying, you know, I looked over this file and we should deny it because that constitutes a debate.
Yep.
if you say, you know what, I think there's more floodplain here, here is my evidence, please consider it for the hearing, whammo, that's it, done, end of discussion, that's fine.
Yep.
Anything informational is fine. Anything based on opinion is not. And if you do that, don't start replying all to each other.
And we don't do that at all.
Even replying to one person constitutes.
And we don't do that at all, and that's not what I'm asking, you know, I'm just asking, and I've got my answer, and thank you very much.
In the course, most all of that does come forward. I mean, I know personally, I've received some emails from Tom Bertram when he couldn't be present that were read into the record at the time that we were considering the action.
And that's what would be the normal process.
Correct, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with that at all.
No, absolutely.
No, yeah, yeah, just to make sure it's into the record. All right, at that point, any other questions or comments? I'll accept a motion to close or adjourn.
So moved.
Motion to second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Have a good night.